Well, hello there, fancy people. Welcome back once again to Die Party Night City, a cyberpunk 2020 adventure with me and my friends. Oh boy, man. Last week that we played this game was a fucking doozy. That ending. Whew, no one saw that coming, except for Peachy.
Multiple times, mind you.
Fucking Christ.
I didn't expect that joke to come out of me, and I'm glad it did. Anyway.
Does anyone have a wet wipe?
So,
yes, I do.
We got a lot to get through tonight, so we're just gonna... I've changed where my camera is for the stream, so I have to, like, look in a different direction. But let's get straight into it and introduce players for tonight. Tessica. Did I say that right this time?
Yeah, actually. You did. You
I've
did,
been
you did.
Practicing. Hey, how you doing? Welcome to the stream. How was your week?
It was good. Yeah. It was rough, but it was good.
Great. Rough as in, like, too much Neo, or rough as in, like, too much running?
Just rough for a variety of reasons. There was running, and the running was good, actually. I kind of decided to take it a little bit easier on myself, and instead of I'm still running the same mileage, I'm just, instead of giving up like a long hilly run to do speed work on the treadmill, I'm just doing a long hilly run because the hills are just like the speed work anyway, and I enjoy the outside way more, that kind of thing. So I just kind of, like, I feel like I was very, like, I had to do everything exactly according to the coach's plan. And then I was just like, screw this shit. I'm supposed to be having fun doing this, not making myself miserable. It's supposed to be stress relief, right? So,
yeah. If you don't mind me asking, and maybe this is just the uninformed and the last time I did any sort of training was when I used to do baseball shit, but that was like almost another lifetime ago. So, like, why does he have you doing things that you don't want to do exactly? Like, what are you aiming for? What are your goals?
So the goal is to run a fast-ish full marathon. The goal right now is to run a fast-ish half marathon, but the eventual goal is in the fall to run a fast full marathon, to run it in a way where I run it fast, but I'm not dying at the end of it. Like, I enjoy it. I run it under 4 hours and it feels relatively easy to do that. And I don't break myself during, so that, like, afterwards I'm like, I never want to run one of these again. Why did I do this? I hate my life, you know? And then I stop running forever. Like, a lot of people do that, and I really don't want to do that. I love running. But what's happened is I can be pretty fast. And so my coach, who's actually pretty awesome, and it's my fault for really not understanding how I would react to this kind of training, because I've never done it before, really. So I guess it's kind of, it's an experiment. I started super early with the coach, because the thing is in November, so I have plenty of time. I started super early with the coach to sort of figure out the kinks, and there are kinks, and that's fine. And so she's going to adjust the plan for me going forward, now that I've realized that, like, I like speed work, but I don't want all of my running to be speed work. Also, where I live affects it. You know, like, if where I lived was super flat and I could just run outside and do speed work from my apartment, that would be great. It would be fine. That's just not the case. There's hills everywhere. I have to drive far away to run hills and to run flats. And I have to do it before it gets dark, because it's not safe.
Yeah.
In my neighborhood, I can run in the dark because it's safe. It's quiet and I know the neighbors, and it's, you know, it's fine. But anywhere I would drive to run where it's flat, it's not like that. So basically it just limits me. It limits how much I can stream, how late I can stream. It limits where I can go and what I can do. And I can't deal with that with running. Running needs to be very convenient and fun and stress relief, not stressful. And it turned out that I was stressing about it a lot. So we're adjusting it. It's a work in progress. Anyway, but it's been good. It's been better this week, because I kind of let go of, like, the nitpicky stuff, and was just kind of like, okay, we're gonna adjust it down the line. It'll be good.
Nice. Now, more importantly, tell us about them video games. Specifically, I want to hear about Neo.
And I'm in love.
I've watched you a little bit with Neo, but I'm trying to stay away from streams because Like, I always do this thing where I get drawn into watching, like, Ella Jazz and some other people speed run these games, right? And I'm just like, oh, I should finish the game before I watch a speed run, because when you watch a speed run, it's like, you just get muscle memory kind of by watching them. But, you know, watching you is kind of nice because it's like, you know, you were in the starting area, I guess, for the most part. And
I'm really slow. If you want to watch me to learn how to play through a game...
Tough shit.
Yeah. I'm sorry. I am stupid slow, especially because I have to play it with keyboard and mouse. Can't use a controller, which has and will continue to make my life difficult in various fun and interesting and ridiculous ways. However, I will always overcome it. Mm-hmm. I've never let it stop me, and I don't plan to. So it's just, you know, it just takes some getting used to and some tweaking and some figuring out exactly the setup that works for me. But I think I have. It's actually really intuitive once you kind of learn the controls and get used to where everything is and make sure that it's comfortable for you, it becomes very intuitive. It becomes muscle memory, and it becomes very, like, you can make decisions, and making those decisions is muscle memory, like what you're actually doing. And it's wonderful. It's so smooth and well-tuned and amazingly done. Like, the controls are almost, I would say, the action is faster, I think, than Bloodborne, which I love. Like, I love Bloodborne. I love Bloodborne over Dark Souls, because even Dark Souls 3, although it's very fast, is not as fast as Bloodborne. Yeah. And Bloodborne is just very speedy. Like, the combat is speedy, and it rewards you even more for being aggressive. And I like that. and Nioh is like that. It's really... Like, you have to think. You can't just button mash or anything like that, but you can definitely push.
Well, it's a Team Ninja game, right? So it's kind of, like, designed around the whole aspect of, like, fast gameplay and precise gameplay.
Yeah, it's very precise. Mm-hmm. It's very precise, it's very fast, and it's beautiful.
Yeah.
And it's interesting. Like, there's so much depth to the combat. There's depth to the story. There's depth to the environments that you move through. There's depth in a lot of different ways. Like, graphically, there's depth, but also, like, there are things that I can't tell you because you're going to play it. But there are other things. Like, for example, there'll be an area where you're on a sort of like a cliff path, right? And some of it will have a guardrail and some of it won't.
Yep.
And so you could easily fall off. And in fact, okay, so this is really cool. If your character gets hit while he's on the edge of the path, depending on how much, like, ki, which is your sort of energy that you use to, like, dodge and do strong attacks and stuff like that, which is kind of like your stamina in Dark Souls. Basically, your ki, depending on how much you have, your character will literally balance on a tiptoe on the edge of the cliff. And, like, either, like, he'll go like this, and then he'll either get back on the cliff or he'll fall off. And it's great. Like, I've had my character get back on the cliff. I've also had my character fall off. And it's just, like, that's such a tiny detail. To have your character teeter on the edge of a cliff and not fall sometimes and fall other times. Like, that is just, to me, I've never seen that in a game, honestly.
Yeah.
You know, it's such a tiny detail thing. It's really cool.
I'm just excited that people are finally making, like, they're using the mechanics of Dark Souls correctly in a way.
Yeah. That makes sense. Yeah, that someone else made another world that's so deep, that's like Dark Souls, but isn't Dark Souls. Like, I love Dark Souls, don't get me wrong, but I want other universes where there's that kind of combat. Like, I would kill for a cyberpunk game.
Yeah, there's one out coming out. It's being made by
what?
Yeah, it's
Jack Red.
Huh?
What is it called?
No, it's called, oh god, what is it? Hang on, I'll look it up.
Actually, if you like the hit scan type combat and you're looking for a fantasy game, I would suggest Monster Hunter, because it is a lot like that with the whole.
I've been watching McLoken play that. That looks so much fun.
I actually have it on my list of games that I'm going to play. It's called The Surge.
The Surge.
It's made by the same guys that made Lords of the Fallen. So, they've already cut their teeth on the Dark Souls stuff. It looks kind of plodding a little bit, but you know. Yeah.
Surge.
Yeah. Anyway, moving on. Peachy Pixelate, the man of the hour, I should say.
The hour?
Well, I mean, this ad, no, next this hour is probably going to be about you, so we'll see how we go with that. What up, sir? How was your week?
My week has only just started. My weekend was pretty good.
I mean, it's been a whole week since our last rendezvous here at Night City, so.
That is true. That is true. No, no idea. I probably did something.
Probably.
What have I been playing? That's an easier question. I've been playing a piece of shit called Guts and Glory.
Is that that fucking 3D Happy Wheels?
What's that like? I need to play that.
Kind of.
What are you doing?
It's supposed to be one of those lol physics or random games, but it's not random enough. So I thought, oh, maybe it's a bit of that, but it's mostly a skill-based, you know, try and keep balanced and that kind of deal. No, it's not skill. It's just shit. They. I feel like they didn't go either way with it. They should have gone full random, like goat similar piece of shit, or they should have gone for the skill angle, but they didn't.
Dude,
they just went
fucking. It's fucking Happy Wheels.
It's kind of like a 3D Happy Wheels, but it's not as good as Happy Wheels. As shameful as that is to say.
They even try and like.
Happy Wheels isn't great, but it's amusing.
There. Jesus, Peachy.
Yeah.
Happy Wheels isn't great. It's amusing, though. You can get like an hour, maybe two of fun out of that. There's none of that.
It's the type of game I would imagine to see on Newgrounds, and you play that once or twice and think, yeah, okay.
I was bored within the fourth fucking mission, but I was like, I'm going to plow on. Maybe they're going to introduce some mechanics here that I'm going to, you know, it's going to. There we go. Okay, that's funny.
Did you play anything interesting? Or did you just play that shit all week?
I started playing Arkham Asylum again.
I can't stand the Batman games. Oh my god.
See, the thing is, Arkham Asylum was my favorite one. I've played the others apart from the latest one.
Maybe I just hate Batman.
Maybe you hate Batman. But I didn't realize how different the other games are. Because it's evolved slowly, game after game.
So which one is this one? This is the first one, right? Of the Batman.
Yeah, this is the first one on the island.
Okay, I played that one a little bit.
So much that it's like if you played the next one, you wouldn't really notice it. But like that combat, they call it Arkham Asylum, Arkham combat, right? It's Batman combat. When they do that in a game, that's what you call it. But yeah, they've actually nuanced it. I didn't realize how much I thought, oh, it'll be the same thing. But it's not. It's not quite the same thing. This one's a little clunky. It's still my favorite because the storyline is... Oh. And yeah. Mark Hamill's Joker is just the best thing ever.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I don't know. Like, that game is just super weird to me. Like, I was going into it being like, yeah, Metroidvania. It's like, yeah.
a lot of corridors in Arkham Asylum.
Yeah.
I mean, I like it because it's so enclosed and it feels claustrophobic, but you do go down a lot of corridors. I never realized
that. Here's
what
you need to do. Just go play Butcher Bay instead. Have a good time.
Butcher Bay?
Mm-hmm.
Chronicles of Riddick?
Yep.
Yeah. Oh,
that game was
amazing.
It's amazing.
Although trying to get it to run in 1080p is a bit of a nightmare.
Apparently they did a remaster of it at some point, so...
Oh, really?
Play that, because...
You should, you know, it's super good.
I have
good.
A soft spot for Riddick.
It's a really good game.
Soft spot for Vin Diesel in general, or just Riddick?
No, not really. I just like the fact that he basically made a couple of films based on a D&D character.
Yeah, and he made another one about a witch hunter. That just
And he got Judi Dench into D&D.
Oh, wow. Cool. She'd be nuts at D&D.
Pitch Black is a very different game.
Okay. Think, interesting fact about Judi Dench. She makes she does cross stitch while she's like on set. Mm-hmm. And it's basically just beautifully cross stitch swearing, and then she will give it to people.
Oh, that's adorable. let's move on to you, Fuzzy. What have you been up to the past week? So.
Hi. Not making beautifully cross stitch swearing, although now I've
had that would be a pretty good stream. And now I'm doing the cursive F. as you can see here. I'm doing a two-tone color.
I fucking hate cross stitch. I can embroider like shit, but I'm not good at cross stitch.
And let's add a little flourish to the cunt.
Yeah. And let's add a little poop emoji here in the corner.
Yeah, I like adding a flourish to that. Anyway, no. I've been, you know, doing stuff. A lot, but yeah, I've mostly been playing Dark Souls, which I'm actually starting to really enjoy now. Yes.
So you got. You're at Quelaag.
No. Quelaag's down. And now I'm...
Yeah. Okay. Tell him how you beat her first.
You jumped under the wall, didn't you?
No. No, okay. I summoned I summoned somebody.
Milford the Maneater?
What's her name as well. So I did it with a couple of summons.
Did you do it with people summons or NPC summons?
One person, one NPC. Because okay. I didn't realize that you...
Yeah, you done fucked up. NPCs, yeah. People will just be like, oh, I've killed this like 900 times. Bop, bop, bop. It ruins the game. Don't do that. You're banned from doing that.
Sorry.
You're banned.
No, it's a blind run. I just went, ooh, a summon sign. I can summon somebody. Boop. Huh. Okay, cool.
Nah, I've only ever people summoned on the second time through because I'm like, it doesn't matter. I've already beaten this guy.
Yep.
Next Storm King.
I didn't summon anyone at all for my entire playthrough of Bloodborne the first time. I was a tryhard, and I was like, I'm either going to learn or I'm not going to learn. There's no way I'm going to learn if I'm going to summon. So I didn't summon.
This is why Dark Souls 1 is bae forever. Because there is a hidden storyline in the NPCs, specifically in the order that you summon them at particular bosses.
Yeah.
It's fucking crazy. And the idea is that you only work this out as if you actually summon them. Like, for example, you can summon Loltrek and Solaire to fight the gargoyles on the top of the church. And then stuff happens. I won't spoil anything. But, like, there's this one person you can get for a boss later on, which is called the Midnight Butterfly, I think it was called.
Moonlight Butterfly.
Yeah. And there's a witch summon that you can get specifically to fight that thing. And if you summon her there, she will show up later because she doesn't die in the game. But if you don't summon her, her armor will show up at a certain place. So it's effectively like the character's
dying.
That's
so cool.
Yeah. And Solaire, you can take Solaire from you from the start of the game all the way to the very end and actually have him fight the end boss with you. But only if you do certain stuff. It's really cool.
Is that Sunbro, yeah?
Yeah, that's the Sunbro.
I summoned in Dark Souls 3 because I didn't summon in Bloodborne and I had such a hard time. Like, I loved it. I'm glad I did that because I don't think I could play Souls games if I hadn't done that.
Yeah.
But I summoned a lot in Dark Souls 3 because I remembered the pain of Bloodborne.
Yeah, I just want to get through this fight and I want to see what's going on. Yeah. Fuck elitism. I'm just going to play the game. So, but yeah, and now I've been going through Sen's Funhouse.
I like to call that Sen's Fuckhouse.
I hate that place so much.
Really? Because the first time I went through it, I was just like, oh, this isn't so bad.
There's a bonfire somewhere, and I don't know where the bonfire is. Where the bonfire is? No, it's a blind run.
it's a real sneaky bonfire, that one, but there is one there. And Sen's Fuckhouse is great. You're about to walk...
getting through it.
Yeah, you're about to walk into Anal Rodeo, which is even better.
Oh, I forgot about Anal Rodeo. Keep reminding me of stuff that I hate.
I haven't played Dark Souls 1 yet.
So it's called Anno Londo.
Rodeo, I forgot.
It's called Anno Londo, but I call it Anal Rodeo because that's basically what it is.
oh God, she hasn't even fought the. She hasn't gotten to the part where the two guys.
Yeah.
No, it's two guys. I'm gonna bet.
Don't scare her. She already looks terrified.
I'm gonna say at least like 15 deaths right there. Mm-hmm.
Oh, at least. I am dying a lot, but...
I'm surprised you made it through Blighttown, even though you found the secret hidden passage.
I made it all the way down. I only found the secret hidden passage after I'd gotten all the way to the bottom.
Yeah, I know. That's fucking excellent. That's the way you're supposed to find it. So I'm glad you made it through Blighttown, because most people are just like, fuck this place, I'm out.
It wasn't that bad. I mean, it was a pain in the dick, but it wasn't like... annoying or infuriating. It's just like, okay, I fucked it up, try it again. It's, you know, it's been like, I haven't been getting annoyed. And every time I start feeling a bit burnt out, I'll just be like, right, time to put the game down and I'll come back when
perfect.
I'm feeling
perfect. Yeah, you're doing it right. I'm so happy that you're doing this game, Fuzzy. It brings a cheer to my heart. Speaking about bringing a cheer to my heart, let's go to the man. What's up? You got more to say?
Yeah, I just wanted to plug the new stream team. This the other thing we've been doing this week is rolling out the new stream team I'm part of called Top Shelf. Yeah, it's cool. There's cool people in it. You should check it out.
Who's in it?
Oh, Jesus Christ.
You don't even know off by heart.
No!
How can you plug it if you don't know who's in it?
Because there's lots of people. It's not lots of people, but, you know, I have a terrible, terrible... No, it's like Cream and Monty Bryson and let me find the thing. Angry Ferg, Anthony Kongfan, Ono Ava, Bougie Demi, Bike Man, Darth Medi, Jack LaFleur, Librizzy, Money Growth and Pocket, Satellizer, Shorty Guy, Yuli, Vanalis, Ohm Wrecker, and some other people who probably aren't in the Discord and therefore don't get shout out. So yeah.
I just heard.
I heard a couple of names there.
Yeah, I heard a couple of them. Yeah.
It's fine.
Please. Yeah. So as I was going to say, the man who's in my heart, sorry, I hit my mic, Mr. Nightmare, what up?
Hello, everyone. I'm Nightmare. Since last week, what have I been doing? We did Void Barons. And on Wednesday, I started Final Fantasy X for the first time ever.
Yeah.
I never really played a Final Fantasy game because I never really had them.
Final Fantasy X is the best Final Fantasy game ever made. Calling it.
The beginning was a little slow, but I'm really liking the storyline now. It's developed.
Oh, do not enjoy it for the story. Do not enjoy it for the writing. Do not enjoy it for the characters.
Oh, that's what I like about most games is the characters and the writing.
Oh, you'll hate it.
Yeah. Anyways, moving on from that. Thursday was the finale of Fulcrum.
Yes, it was.
I mean, most of you were there.
Yes, it was.
Friday, what did I do Friday? Oh, yeah, we didn't have Omen, so I continued Final Fantasy. Same as on Saturday. And now I'm back here. Sunday, I fucked off and played WoW.
Nice. Like, as you do.
As I do on Sundays. I'm like, Chip, I do not have a guild who can raid with me. I have a tank buddy, me, and then three lower geared DPS. So we can't do anything.
So speaking about fucking off with WoW, let's go on over to the man who fucks off with WoW. Chip, what have you been up to?
Just kidding. but I am doing good, and I am actually loving all this love for Dark Souls, because that's like one of those games that I have a weird connection with it. I'm always, whenever I do a Dark Souls game, other than patches, I'll just turn off the internet connectivity because I just want to solo man through it. And one of the things, if you guys don't know, is that there is so much lore you can get just from like items, and when you do multiple runs, you can end up just like going like two drastically different paths, and all of the item texts help tell a story, as well as the limited interactions with NPCs. There's actually a YouTube channel that I recommend called Vati Vidya, where he goes through and he compiles all this type of stuff, and one of his series is called Prepare to Cry.
You have to be really into Dark Souls to even get any of the shit he's talking about, though.
See, one of the things I'm probably going to do is when I finish Dark Souls, I'm going to go just sit and read through the wiki.
Oh, yeah, no, 100%. That's what you should do. Because aside from experiencing this game, like, come out of the internet, like, it's... Yeah, like, I always try to play these games, like, as fast as I can because of the fact that the internet will wreck me. And I know what I'm like with wikis.
I had somebody come in today just being like, sort of like, your weapon is not good enough, blah, blah, and just been really shitty about the fact I was using an axe.
Yeah, the backseating in Dark Souls games,
you're doing enough damage,
fucking excruciating.
I'm fine with it. Oh my god, I apparently sold the Dark Knight's sword to that big chompy dude because I'm like, I don't use it.
Yeah.
Yeah, know what I said to those people? I finished all of Dark Souls with the starting broadsword. I did not care.
I've been in the game Soul Level 1, so what up, nerds? Yeah. Come at me, find me.
I finished Bloodborne with the axe, the starting axe.
Yeah.
I love that thing.
That was my weapon in Bloodborne.
Yeah, I've got
Bloodborne had like 11 weapons. That doesn't really count.
Well, in Dark Souls, I found a love for going the, you get a bow, and then you wear no armor. And basically, you get hit once, you go down. But if you're really good at dodging, you'll get any boss down. And it's pretty challenging. I actually really like that.
I'm not.
But the something interesting for you guys, and we can talk about it later if you'd like. There's a role-playing game for anybody who's interested called Simbarum. And for me, it takes after Dark Souls because one of the core mechanics is in the game is as a DM, I am trying to kill you. Like, that's just the core mechanic of the game. Magic you use in the game will murder you, turn you into a giant aberration, and then you get to go and kill your friends.
Yeah, that sounds like a real good time.
I love it. I don't know what it is. I just like, I love those types of games. Yeah, where you get that
sadistic sort of twinge to you, Chip. I'm not going to lie.
Well, you know, you just get to inject your players into that just really dark, brooding atmosphere. Everything is horrible. And then you instantly, like, into the thing of, oh, you see, like, a little house with, like, one light turned on. It looks somewhat abandoned. Nope, we're not going to go in. But there's treasure. There might be treasure in there. No, we know you too well. That's not going to happen. We're just going to go sleep in the forest. Oh, okay, so how are you sleeping? We're going to hang up in trees. Okay. Now, you remember that time you told me you were a restless sleeper? Yeah. Roll a dice for me. Oh, you fell out of the tree.
yeah.
Oh, luckily I tied myself to the tree. Oh, good job, man. Let's see.
Yeah.
Oh, a giant came along and grabbed you down and threw you into his like little food hole that he has, and now the rest of the team has to go and try and kill a giant to save you.
It's a food hole. Most people call that a mouth.
Well, no, it's a spare food hole, you know.
All right.
I mean, I call that something else.
We've been talking this shit long enough. We got to get into this. I've been putting it off long enough. I think it's time. So last time we played Die Party Night City, we had a great little adventure where we killed two cops with mustaches. That was fun. And then we went to go collect the reward. And needless to say, it wasn't enough for dear old Vi. She wanted more. And that's what she got. So we are now starting our session in the aftermath of what transpired. So let me set the scene. Previously, it was described as a room that was filled with men. Those men have since left. And what's left is a very tired and worn out looking Vi. And Hammer is in the room as well. Now, if you remember Hammer, he was the leader of this gang. He has basically giant spiky metal arms, replacing his own arms. And yeah, I do believe that our friend Nina had some words for you, Vi.
What the fuck is wrong with you? What were you thinking, putting yourself in that kind of situation? Did you not think that it would affect the rest of us? Did you think it was okay?
Yes, I just used up my last surgical. These gloves don't grow on trees, you know.
I mean, I don't care if you don't care about yourself one flick. Where are your partners? We care about you. Who the hell gives you the right to go and do something like that to yourself and then force us to rescue you?
Force you to rescue me? The fuck? I just got us a place to buy some shit.
You did also sustain some fairly bad trauma down there. I mean, that's
nothing you could have gotten for us is worth what you just did to yourself. Nina,
what the fuck do you think I just did to myself, sugar?
That's just not an okay thing to do. It's not an okay situation to put yourself in. And you did that.
I also had to use your cut to, you know.
Oh, he gave that back to you.
They don't know.
Oh, okay, fair enough.
Why are you all pissing around me like I'm some sort of 4-year-old that needs nursing?
It's not about being a 4-year-old. There was nothing about that situation that was even remotely okay for anyone ever that has any respect for themselves.
You were catatonic, non-responsive, obviously in some kind of fugue state. So
you could have died, you stupid girl.
Me, died, really?
Yeah, you could have died. You could have died or worse. God knows what they could have done to you.
Yeah, you could have prolapsed. No right. I mean, you were coming quite close to a prolapse there. I mean,
just, bitch, I could die in the street tomorrow. What the fuck is this?
I'd be very careful when sneezing or coughing. Just, you know, just FYI.
Look, I know you. I believe you'd rather die shooting a gun than getting loaded up with a bunch of metalheads. No offense.
None taken.
That doesn't even make sense.
So,
look, I did what I needed to do to get me some fucking bullets. Some troglodyte wants to put his dick in me. What the fuck do I care?
No offense. Well,
you know,
he didn't put his dick in me.
You realize it wasn't one. You realize it was, I don't even know how fucking many.
Well, I need more than one bullet, honey.
She does have a point there. Especially the way you went through those bullets, Lucy. Next time, look, just flat out. Next time, warn us. One. I barely
next time
know
we'll
you guys.
Leave you there. I'm sorry.
What the fuck difference would it make?
You don't give a crap about you. You don't give a crap about yourself. Fine. No one else will.
Look, knife bitch. We can't all have picket fences to go home to. Go fuck Paul. I'll do what I gotta do to survive.
You don't think I've been where you've been? You don't think I've been through what you've been through? You have no fucking clue what you're talking about. None.
You have no idea what I've been through, sugar.
Nina walks out.
Ladies, please.
To say.
All right.
This is done. Not the, this is not the time or place.
I'm going to run after her and stop her from walking away.
Okay. I mean,
and sort of pull around.
As much as this, let me just point this out. As a role playing game, as much as the sort of like forcing you to stay and talk sort of stuff goes, that's up to the players, right? If Nina's character really wants to go, then by
yeah, no,
all
I
means,
my
then,
character hasn't finished talking to her.
Okay, fair enough.
I mean, Nina has nothing to say. She's literally walking out the door.
I'm like, I go outside the door so I'm away from the other chuckle fucks.
Okay. You are now in a chuckle fuck free state.
Nina, honey, don't fucking judge me. I did what I needed to do. You don't
it
know what I
it has nothing to do with judging you. It has nothing
I can see
to
it in your
that.
Face.
You made me fucking care about you. And I've done that. I've been in that situation before. You could have died and you were my friend. And what you had done to yourself is not okay. It's just not. And it has nothing to do with judging you. And if that's what you have to say to me, I'm out of here. And you don't want anyone to give a fuck about you. You don't give a fuck about yourself. Fine. I won't. Goodbye. I'm done.
As she walks off, never ask no one to give a fuck about me.
So, where are you going to go, Nina?
Too angry to be around people. I'm gonna run.
Yeah, you're gonna go for
run
a sprint.
Around the city.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. So where you are right now is the docks of Night City, which you know for the most part are relatively okay. You've been around the block, right? You know the places where you can go. That's fine to do whatever it is that you need to do. You blow off steam. You know, slice up a couple of. Oil cans. I don't know what it is that you would need most, but yeah, there you would be able to navigate your way around without running into problems. So you run and how long would you say that you would spend out by yourself?
Wait, I'm just imagining that, like, 80s montage. And I ran.
No,
I ran so far away.
It's probably nothing like that. This is more of a song.
The mood
is a very angry run.
Yeah.
This is, and I'm running so fast that, like, I'm a blur and no one can touch me. I'm that pissed off right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I probably run until morning, whatever the heck time it is, until it's day and people would mind seeing a random blur with blade legs. And then I
do you have,
pass out in a corner somewhere.
Do you have any sort of endurance skills?
I don't remember. I actually have no idea. That's a good question.
Let's take a look. So you have no endurance skills. So endurance is what you would have to roll in order to run for a long period of time. There's no reason to stop you from, you know, doing your normal running, right? But what you described is a very intensive sort of thing.
I just kind of, like, I think Nina at this point just wants to not be thinking until she can't.
Yeah.
Because she's too mad and it hits too close to home. So
where do you inadvertently end up running? Like, you are, like, deep down, deep seated, you would have a place that you would have ran to, right? That's what I'm imagining in my mind's eye, but unless you're just running until you literally pass out. You know what would probably happen? You would, what would happen first before you passed out from, you know, exhaustion? You would probably, your attachments, your limb attachments would probably start bleeding more than anything else. The strain and stuff like that you're putting on not so much like the attachments themselves, but just sort of the nubs where your flesh meets metal. Right, that's the part that would get strained the most here. Not so much your body or your mind, but those parts in particular.
Okay, so maybe I run until that starts to happen.
Yeah.
Until I'm in pain and I literally can't run anymore. And then I go to Paul's, I guess.
Yeah, roll for me a body type check, please.
Okay.
Just hit body type on the stats. That's what you need to do.
I did, but it won't let me do anything.
Really?
Yeah. Do I need to, like, click myself first?
No.
It won't let me do anything. That's weird.
Well, that rolled for me. Maybe just refresh the page.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I've had it open since last week. That's probably why.
Yeah.
Shut your computer down.
That'll never happen. Ever.
My OCD.
Okay, but it worked for you, right?
So yeah, it worked for me. Again? Yeah, yep. Just roll again. I only accept players rolling. There you go. You got better. So yeah, you run, and you probably weren't even paying attention to where you ran, or doing anything of those sorts. And you probably would have inadvertently ended up at Paul's house. Now, Paul isn't there at this time. What are you gonna do?
I mean, I'm a thief, right?
You gonna break in?
I'm gonna break in.
Perfect. I like
and
it.
And I'm gonna break in. Like, I'm not gonna break shit. I'm just gonna use my lockpicks or whatever. And
you're not gonna elbow a window and.
And I'm just gonna kind of start to clean myself up and just kind of pass out in his bathroom.
Yeah.
So that's how he finds me.
I like to imagine that the scene is, you know, you lockpick in. Do you even have skills for that? I just want to get an idea of how you actually get into this guy's place. Not that you can't, just an idea of how. So we can set the scene. I don't think you have any, no, you don't have a pick lock. So, you'd probably maybe rock through a window or something like that. Or enough, you cut a hole big enough to fit your arm around and unlock the door sort of thing. You would do something like that.
Your credit card and the lock trick.
And not on a front door. That would never work. But yeah, you force your way into this man's home, and you probably, at this point, most likely, drag yourself over to the bathtub and you take off your legs, and we look down at your bloody stumps, raw from running. Not so much bloody, but just very raw from running. And yeah, you just sort of, I don't know, fall asleep wherever it is that you fall asleep. So that was a couple of hours. So what was the other, what was Team Alpha doing during that time?
I thought we were Team Tucklefox.
Sorry, yes, Team Tucklefox, yeah.
So, we're standing there with Hammer, Lucy, and Voxel. And Nina and Vi ran outside. Yeah. So, like, looking at Hammer. So, she's good now, right? She don't need nothing else?
Yeah. Now, stores are open to you, Chuckle Fucks.
Could really go for a cup of tea right about now.
Yeah. Right. Voxel, what else does the van need to get it running again?
Oh. What doesn't it need?
I don't know. I'm not a car guy.
You want our boys to take a look at it?
If you'd be so kind.
Yes. It's pretty much held together with gaffer tape and spit at the moment, so yeah.
What the hell's gaffer tape?
Oh my god!
I don't know.
It is just so fortuitous, dude. I met you at a bar. I didn't even see your arms yet. Oh, we're like family, man. Oh, I'm loving this. Any more work you need done, just throw it my way. Ooh.
I mean, there is stuff, but seems your heavy hitter ran off.
Yeah.
Oh, she'll be back. Don't worry.
Hopefully she'll be back. We're gonna lay low and have everyone calm down for a bit.
Yeah, it's been a bit of a day. We've had a day today.
So, Henley, I want to... I was reading up a little bit on family, my ability.
Okay.
And I think that I can use it as kind of like a cred, possibly. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to see if I can't just like... If there's not like some way that like I get all excited about, you know, car stuff, right? And then I say something like along the lines of, oh man, just like you guys retrofitting your bodies, we're going to retrofit this car Metalski style, right? But I want to see if that has any effect on these guys, because I don't know if anybody has heard of my roaming biker military clan.
So it's kind of interesting because family, the actual skill represents your place in the family. It doesn't represent your family size. And that's never been established with you. So if you want, we have to establish what that family is ahead of time. And now I know you've written a little bit about how they were like roaming marauders and all that sort of shit. And they do like road warrior style missions and stuff like that. But we've never really described their impact that they had on Night City. Keeping in mind that these guys are really deep into the combat zone and, you know, they're very small compared to other gangs. Mm-hmm. So we need to get an idea of what sort of influence your family had. Or what do you think they would have done here? What would you think their objective would have been coming into Night City?
Well, the first thing that I thought of them as is just kind of like, it's kind of like it started off as just like a group of DJs wanting to be out on the road or people wanting to escape from Night City. But normally it would be with a cause, and then it just kind of exploded from there. And it just ended up being a lot of people with technical and military backgrounds. So it's just kind of like a nomad of, you know, you get like your ex-cops, you get your ex-security forces and stuff like that. And then they're just tired of Night City. They want out. They want to be on the open road. They want to explore the wasteland.
But they weren't from Night City. That's the whole point of families. They just do whatever they want.
Oh, no. I mean, like tradition line, if you would. It's more of a military type family type thing. Like if I were to ever be with my group, I'd be referring to people as sir and ma'am, right? Even though Voxel is kind of like crazy and road
so worthy. Okay, before you go too deep into this, would you say it's more like a military company than a family?
Yeah I feel like it's kind of both. It's kind of like, you know, the blood of
brothers. Are you born into this? Is that how it works?
Born and accepted through skill, or I guess effort.
Right. Okay. How long has the family been running for?
Let's say something interesting like 30 to 50 years.
So what, two generations of family then?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Maybe Vox is just like on the very cusp of like the third gen.
Well, you would have to have kids for that kid to be the third gen, but yeah.
Yeah, true. Whatever.
Yeah. All right. Okay. So that gives me an idea. Now, what do you think their objective would have been here in Night City?
I think they might have come through stock ups and maybe connections. But I also think that they're the type of group who might accept odd jobs from corps just for money. And a tie in that I thought was they might have been the perfect people to be hired by Arasaka to do the midnight animal raids. If you want to tie that in, I just like tying in the past stories and stuff.
That's kind of rough because these guys were essentially, I mean, you smack on the money, but the way you described it is different.
Okay.
Midnight Animal was, in case you're like scratching your head or whatever, anyone who doesn't know, Midnight Animal played a big part in the first Night City story arc that we had. It was I won't spoil it too much, but it was basically just a gang of people wearing animal masks and causing mischief and burning down buildings and stuff like that, you know, being vandals. But I would say no, mostly because of the fact that the way you described your family is in fact militarized, and these guys were far from it, even in the way that they work and act and do business. These guys were completely different. But if you want, they could have done missions. And with a family that size, I mean, it probably would have made an impact higher up, but I doubt someone this deep into the combat zone would have found them or did anything with them. The only thing that I could say is maybe there were rumors, but if your family's militarized, what would their code name be?
I think the surname is the quote unquote company name, Metalski.
All right, that's fine. So if you mention something like that, why don't you go ahead and make a family check? This will be the roll that would decide it.
Cool. Shit.
I'd say this Dave is probably a 15. Nah, there you go. That's pretty. What is your family? A 6?
6. Yeah.
You level it up?
Yes, I did.
Huh. That's interesting.
So it's about time he used it.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, family's interesting because family allows you to call for reinforcements, right, from your family and have them show up to help you with things. But his family doesn't exist anymore, so I'm not entirely sure how you managed to level up a thing about a family that you're no longer a part of or exist with. Now, I could see this being like a maybe with this leveling up, you sort of, maybe Hammer is like, oh, you're a Metalski, huh?
Yes, sir. Burn and raise, sir.
I knew a couple of your clan.
Oh, really? Who'd you meet them at?
Oh. It's Chip Metalski.
Whoa! He's two generations back, one of the founders. That's rad.
Yeah,
man, Chip
well,
was just all sorts of in everything, wasn't he? He was really in it.
I don't know. I didn't really like the guy, to be honest with you, but he did a lot of good business for us, so.
Oh, that's good to hear. Blood runs deep, you know what I mean?
As long as you don't cause any problems here, I don't have any problems having a Metalski buy from us.
Hey. I'm stranded from the back. I'm just trying to make my way in the world until I hook back up with the convoy.
So, yeah, what's the plan, guys? What are you doing?
I'm just trying to find a cup of tea.
Good luck. That's the one thing you'll probably never find in this place.
I think with the most important thing right now is... So, dudes, all right, let's focus down a little bit. Mm-hmm. We got raided. Mm-hmm. We did a job. They seem to somewhat like us here.
You crashed our van. Yeah.
I crashed my van. Thank you very much.
I fixed it somewhat. We got here, didn't we?
And I taught you about metal, didn't I? Yeah. So, here's the great thing about it. We might be able to lay low and let y'all who did, like, all that cyber stuff to your bodies recuperate a little bit. We have no idea where Nina ran off to. We might want to reconnect with her. So I'm thinking R&R, we restock.
Oh, come on. You know she went off to Fuckboy's house.
That is true, where else? But I don't know where that is.
Oh, Paul.
I think he likes to name Mr. Fuckboy.
That's Dr. Fuckboy to you. Yeah,
Dr. Fuckboy. Thank you.
Dr.
Fuckboy. So I'm not with them. I'm like sitting on some crate smoking something. And to anyone just to look at me, I just look like I don't give a fuck. But actually, I'm kind of upset because I didn't actually realize Nina was my friend until she ran off.
Are we gonna have like a fucking Milo and Otis style thing with you two soon? Except
we're both psychopaths, so we might actually just kill each other.
Milo and Otis is a cat and a dog that became friends and traveled across the countryside.
This is the all he's lost.
Nina's really mad.
So, true. I think what we should do is appease our betters and say, oh, we're repairing the van, but this is like our only home or some shit like that, right? Then once the van's up and running, that'll give us 2 or 3 days. We get some R&R in, we restock our supplies, and we figure out what the hell we're going to do because we're back to being homeless.
So Hammer's standing over you and he's just like,
Well, if you want to stay here, you have to work.
I am fine with that.
Could I interest you in some of my fine vintage as well?
He sort of looks at you and he's like, you got booze?
Oh, yes, I've got booze. Only the finest fuck wine for you, sir.
He just sort of raises an eyebrow and he's like, you called it fuck wine?
She's not, she's in charge of marketing.
So, huh. And
it does what it says on the tin, okay? I like to be descriptive.
And with that, we'll take a quick break.
Fuzzy's looking to see if she can't sell off some of her stuff, and we might have some interpersonal communications trying to.
I'm interested in fine toilet wine, sir.
How much do you sell le doudoir le fuck wine for?
Chateau fuck.
Chateau le de fuck wine.
Le de fuck wine? No.
Made Chateau only in fuck. The finest fuck. Chateau of fuck. Bitters.
There we go. Chateau de fuck.
Aged for 25,000 years.
Minutes. No, minutes. 25 minutes.
For at least 25 seconds.
We sieve the larger
spun around inside of a car outside of Night City to give it
larger chunks.
Yeah, sieve through an old man's
its surroundings and what it's gone through.
We kind of cleaned the toilet when we made it.
Chateau de Toilette.
Chateau de Toilette. Brilliant. Yes, yeah.
The defining feature, it will strip the paint off the toilet when it's done.
It would make the toilet sparkle like the teeth you will have after you drink it.
Just the teeth you won't have after you drink it.
There's probably teeth in the wine, just dissolved.
Night City Police Department use it to clean blood off the streets.
Also, you know, you stick a rag in there, instant Molotov, it's great.
What would that kind of thing go for, Henley?
Yeah, I have no idea.
Yeah, well, I mean, this is you guys deciding how much you want to sell your swill for.
Oh God, give us a ballpark rough figure. For
I'm
20.
Not giving you shit.
God damn it, I don't.
Oh no, we
just get Hal to roll and say it's €1 million a glass.
It is that okay. Good.
He's selling it by the glass and by the bottle. Like, what's going on?
By the bottle, right? I'm gonna turn to whoever has the higher sort of like, you know, people wrangling skills and stuff, because I'm just like
that's definitely me.
I think that
What if we get them to install like a wet bar in the van, and then we just like roll up in Hoboken, open up the doors, and we're just a mobile
like a taco truck for toilet wine.
No, I remember it. There's
no, we don't even have to make a wet bar. We just have to install a couple more toilets in there.
It has the plumbing set up for it. Like it actually does store to a like two.
Yeah, but you'd be able to sell literally none. It'll take like a fucking like fortnight just to brew up one batch, and then like maybe 9 people could drink it.
I am so well acquainted to this verbiage you're using, Henry. I quite enjoy this riveting conversation.
I you have such an earthly texture.
It comes from the fuck line, don't you know? It just tantalizes my palate.
Tantalizes my palate. Okay.
By tantalize, you mean gently dissolve, yes?
Yes. My palate, it was non-existent beforehand, and now it doesn't exist at all.
Yeah. The roof of my mouth, it's just not there.
Yeah.
So, we call it the Bob Ross killer.
Damn. All right, so what are you selling this for? Give me a ballpark. You got 91 bottles of fuck wine on the wall still to go. Or maybe a little less. I don't know. Did a few more break? I can't remember. Did you write them down? I gave you a number to write down, Fuzzy. If you didn't write it down, I'm going to say you had 88 if you don't tell me you had a different number.
Right, hang on. It's in here somewhere, but I have a lot of...
You have a character sheet. Write it on the fucking character sheet.
Did you say there was 90... I remember you singing the song 98 bottles of
No, there was 92 because I made her roll. I know that much. But then I said a couple of broke because the car flipped.
91. There we go.
All right.
Yeah. I thought I'd written it.
And you gave one away to someone.
So 90.
Okay. Great. Perfect. You have 90 bottles of fuck wine left. How much are you selling them for? Keeping in mind of what you put in it.
I don't remember how much the ingredients cost. That's the thing.
There you go. Let's see.
So what do you guys think we should sell these for?
What's
Hey, look, you know what? So... I'm putting you on the spot right now, Fuzzy. The guy's asking you how much they're costing and you cannot converse. Give me a number. Let's go.
Oh, God, I hate you so much, Henley.
Welcome to Street Deal with Hammer. Today we have on the block of fuck wine.
Is there any, ten credits a bottle?
All right.
€10 a bottle.
€10
a bottle. That shit away for free?
God fucking damn it!
Okay, so he just like, you know what? He's just like, yeah, okay. Even if it's swill at €10 a pop, it can't be that bad. So he'll,
I should have asked for more.
He'll buy 10 bottles of it from you.
Okay.
So you get 100 credits.
Wow, I feel like I just made a terrible, terrible deal.
Bottles cost more than that.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know about the bottles, but I do remember that we only sent the kids off with about €100 to gather ingredients.
No, so it was €1,000, I think you'll find. They had to go and get cold medicine and all of that shit.
So it's cost prohibitive at the moment.
Yeah. So, €100. Write that down. Mark down 10 bottles down.
Yep, done it.
Sweet.
Let's be like, was that a good deal or not?
Do you have your records, your bookkeeping, your tracking, overhead cost?
Yeah.
Time management?
They were in the house.
Why didn't you talk to this guy first?
We get a picture of the house that's on fire. It's like...
of course it was in the house.
I've got the recipe, but I didn't bring the...
Okay, make a profit so, if we don't know how much everything costs.
Yeah, they will take a drink.
I'm a scientist, not a merchant!
They will take a drink of this. Whew, man. Just to give everyone who's playing at home a reminder of what the fuck our dear Fuzzy put into this thing. Let's take a look. So
you sell the first batch for cheap and then they get addicted and you hike up the price.
So it's got... it negates pain, aka it makes you feel numb. It has an aphrodisiac in it. It gives you a -5 to resist seduction checks. It has psychological addiction of 10 points, meaning that it's a negative 10 to pass body type saves after they fail their 25 DC endurance test. Gang, damn it. That's a real spicy meatball. It tastes more like medicine than it does wine. But golly, goddammit, does it taste good.
It gets you drunk and it does what it says on the bottle. It makes me want to fuck.
So, yeah. you know, they drink it. And it's like, oh. Oh, it tastes so bad. Did you drink any of this stuff beforehand, Fuzzy?
Me? No, yeah. I'm teetotal.
What does that mean?
She doesn't drink. Have you not noticed that wherever we've been in a bar, she's been there with a glass of water just like...
Ah, yes. But what is that word, though? I've never heard that word before.
Teetotal, yeah.
Teetotal. Other English speakers, we call it sober.
Oh, he's Australian. I get it. I get it.
Sober, okay. Dry,
dry. Okay, yeah. Cadbury. Yes. Right, I get you. So
I've never heard that word.
Cadbury.
Yeah, like the egg. The Cadbury Cadbury refers to when someone is really easy and gets drunk really easy. Like one beer drunk. You know, Cadbury.
No, she doesn't drink at all.
And that's what I'm saying. But because you don't drink, you're also a Cadbury.
Oh yeah, probably. Yeah.
So. We've basically we get a montage of these guys drinking and they immediately come back for more. They're just like, oh, I mean, if you've got more, we'll take it. It tasted like swill, but it's not so bad. Puts hair on the chest.
It does, yes. We are running a little low on it, so
doesn't matter, we're buying up the stock.
Okay. I think perhaps we could
One of the guys is gonna be like, he'll see where you get the bottle from. You're like, oh, they got more in here, and they'll go and grab it.
Hang on. Right, hang on. Just let me grab my calculator a second, because I literally
can't. It looks like you got 80 left. How about we give you 800 credits for it right now?
Okay. That's 8, 8, 8. Yeah.
So yeah, they take it all back with them, and they they start having a drinking party. Yeah.
So, did you turn out a profit on that?
Did you raise the price even slightly on a bottle?
Was big. Okay, he was big, and I got flustered. I'm sorry. Look, I'm not. I think perhaps somebody else should handle the negotiations for now, because I'm not good at I'm just, look. I'm not a people person. Okay, I am not a people person.
Lucy. I'll handle your bookkeeping. You focus on just making more fuck wine and making it better, or cheaper, faster. However. Lower our cost, I'll handle the negotiations and the bookkeeping.
Well, where am I going to get more cough medicine now? I mean,
that's a good point.
I'm out of ingredients right now. Unless we want to, like... And these guys are probably going to get a bit, you know, antsy when we run out as well.
Let's let them go through tonight. Tomorrow, when they need more, or when they recognize their stock is low, we'll talk to them and see if we can't set up some kind of operation to get a large amount of cold medicine. But for now, I say we enjoy the night. Everyone will cool their heads. I'm going to go drink some fuck wine.
I'm not sure if that's a good idea, to be honest
with
you.
I'm not actually going to drink the fuck wine.
Okay, good.
It's called making relationships.
All right, so let's...
People.
Let's flick the camera over to our other now solo party member, Nina. What are you up to over there? You probably come back. You probably wake up actually, At the point of a barrel, the barrel of a gun is pointed at you with a light in your eye. What do you do?
Wait, really?
Yeah.
Okay, I wasn't expecting that. I was expecting Paul to be nice.
I mean, when he sees it to you, obviously, he's going to put away the gun. But you wake up at his gunpoint, the middle of the night, basically, pitch black. And, you know, remember, you did force your way into his house. So, like, it's probably the reason why he's got his gun out.
Okay, then. Maybe I in dazed, am very confused by this gun in my face. And I'm just like, Paul?
and he's like, oh, Nina. So he'll, like, you know, put the flashlight away. And he'll put the gun back in his holster and be like, you broke into my house.
I had nowhere else to go.
And he'll like throw his like he'll throw like a suitcase on the bed and it's like, well, that makes both of us.
Fuck.
Why, what happened? I thought you had a home away from home.
Those people are morons.
Yeah. I'm starting to get that feeling.
So why are you packing?
Well, it's hard to pay the rent when you're, you know, out of a job. I spent the entire day walking around trying to find if there's any security gigs hiring, but as it turns out, it's very easy to get blacklisted in a city. So.
Fuck. I'm so sorry, Paul.
Well, I mean, you know, there's maybe a couple of gigs I could work doing some, you know, merc work, but it's not pretty and it's not safe. It's not cushy like watching old people, but it is what it is.
I don't want to put you in any more danger.
Oh. Kind of have to now. Danger's not really, I mean, if you look at it like this, danger's kind of what you put yourself into. So if we plan and we precise about what we're doing, and you know, I take a job that's relatively safe, I think I'll be okay. I'm a little worried about you though. I mean, when was the last time you had a shower?
Love one right now, actually.
Well, the water's still hot, at least for another couple of hours. Go nuts. Oh, and do you need help?
Do you want to join me?
Maybe you should put your legs on first, otherwise it's going to be a little awkward.
I can do that.
So, you know, you two will have a final romantic evening together. And how much of this situation with Via do you tell him, if
anything? Nothing.
Any? Nothing? All right.
Nothing. I know Via better than I know Paul by far, I think. And I mean, this whole thing that happened with her based on what happened with Nina in the past, right? The whole reason that Nina's so mad for two reasons, yeah. Right? For anyone that doesn't get that, she's mad because A, she cares about Vi, and Vi purposely put herself in a situation where she could die, like Nina could lose her, and that made her angry and made her scared and made her, you know, she didn't realize she cared so much, and that makes her angry. The whole thing is just bad, right? And the other part of it is that Nina went through that not by choice and just doesn't understand how Vi could be okay with it at all.
Yeah, it's kind of a weird situation. It's like you two get along famously, and then there's this one big thing that's just like it fractured the relationship that you had. Are you interested in continuing to mend such a relationship?
Yeah, I mean, she still cares, right? And that's why she's not telling Paul anything, because like Paul is kind of a stopgap, an escape, And like, Nina cares about Paul. She doesn't want anything bad to happen to him. That's why she asks, you know, like, that's why she says things like, oh, I don't want you to, because she could bring him in fully, right? But she doesn't want him to get more hurt. And at the same time, she doesn't want to start caring about him that much. Yeah. She's not ready for that.
So, you know, maybe, you know, you can, there's something that goes on between two people when they share intimacy, right? It's a moment of clarity, somewhat kind of akin to like skinship, I guess, would probably be the best way to describe it. You get to know someone's physical behavior, I guess, in a way that is hard to describe. And role-playing games, I think, kind of suffer a lot from missing that sort of particular thing about relationships. But what I'm going to assume here is that Paul notices there's a lot of hesitation in you. And this is mostly due to the fact that of what you said, but it's also to do with how you're acting and your body language and that sort of stuff. So he's just gonna, maybe as you guys are like, you know, drifting off to sleep for the last time in this bed of his, I guess, he's just gonna turn to you and he's gonna say, you know, I'm a lot more capable than you make me out to be. In fact, I think I could probably do this homeless gig a lot better than you could. And I'm willing to put money on it. How much are you worth? He'll pull out like 20 euro bucks and put it between you two.
Okay, that makes Nina laugh because yeah. She doesn't know what to say.
That's twice the price of fuck wine.
Oh my God. All right. That is
Nina wishes that Vi was there. Okay, so how about this? How about Nina has that thought that that's what Vi would say?
Yeah.
And then Paul sees her kind of smile at that thought and then sees her get upset and close down because she's thinking about Vi all of a sudden. And she really doesn't want to care about Paul that much. She's not ready.
Okay.
And so she says, part of me wants to trust you, but or maybe she doesn't even say that. Maybe she just says, I'm not there yet.
Yeah, 20 euro bucks is a lot.
Okay, so that makes her laugh. She doesn't say anything else. She just laughs. And then she kisses him.
Yeah.
So maybe she's trying to tell him that she's not there yet, but maybe she'll get there.
Yeah, sure. So we can fast forward. Well, you know what? We get a montage of like a maelstrom party. I guess.
Oh dear God.
Is what's sort of happening here. There's a lot of bravado. There's a lot of like heavy metal. And there's a lot of like cars with headlights on and a fight circle probably between people inside of this thing. And they're all just like super hyper aggressive. They're like, oh, you know, punching each other and shit.
Lucy's just sort of sat on a box somewhere with a glass of water.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, the nights are very different for our two separated parties, I guess. We got the chuckle fucks who are dealing with a situation. Actually, you know what, Vi, let's step into your mind a little bit here. What's going on there? What's happening?
With what regard to the party?
To your mind. Like, what's happening? You're in a headspace, bro. Tell me about that space of yours.
Oh, with the Nina thing? I don't know. I think she just, like, every time it sort of comes up into her mind, she just tries to get rid of it because she doesn't.
And how do you get rid of it? What is your escape method?
I shoot myself.
Okay, just like, you know.
Just pull the trigger.
Yeah, no, cool. Well, the bullets you brought,
I don't know. See, the thing is, this kind of relationship has never happened to Vi because, like, all her relationships have been absolute bullshit. Like, yep. No one's actually ever cared for her. So I think she doesn't do what she'd normally do. She'd just go out and, you know, have a fight, shoot some people, drink some beer. I think she's just, like, totally brooding. Like, everyone's having a good time. She's just, like, sat somewhere, just smoking, staring into space. I mean, to anyone else looking, she just looks like she's got her normal resting bitch face on. But, like, on the inside, she's actually, like, she's kind of hurting, I think.
Okay, great.
She doesn't think she's done anything wrong, but she is hurting that she's done something wrong that Nina doesn't like.
Yeah. And Voxel, I assume you're partying down with the broskies?
Yeah, man. Yeah. Chance to fight and look at cars.
And Hal, what are you doing?
I like to think Hal is trying to include himself into this type of atmosphere. So, you know, you said there's a fight circle, so he'd be like there in the middle. He's like, all right,
I like the idea that you've like someone's asked to fight you and you're just like, all right, you take off your shirt and you just fucking like you go warrior on everyone.
So, you know, his shirt's opened up, you see his muscles, he's a big dude. And he's like, all right, so he's got these two.
You're very like hairy dude on your chest.
Oh, he's hairy as fuck.
Okay.
he's just like a bear, like a big angry bear.
I like it.
I imagined him completely waxed. That's so, changed.
No, just his head. Over his head is completely clean. But like below, I mean, he's just hair.
Like hair on the shoulders and the back, like
hair.
Okay.
He doesn't take off his shirt much.
Basically a silverback then.
I'm thinking like fat bastard style, you know, like
a little bit. But, so he's but like, black, right, not ginger. Men, I want a fair fight. Nothing below the waist. No weapons, fists only. And if you don't, you just like grab one of them. Bam, metal head plate. I'll do that to you.
Oh and yeah, you've got the.
I got a metal head plate now.
That's right, yeah. Yeah, and when you do that, a little bit of blood comes out. You're not fully healed from that shit. But, so yeah, that the night goes on.
Yeah, as you're doing that, Lucy's just like, God damn it.
Yeah. And Lucy, you're just like, I like to imagine you're that awkward shy girl at a party. Like, maybe someone will fall down next to you and you'd be like, ugh. And you like scooch over a little bit or something?
Not awkward and shy, just deeply uncomfortable with you know, other humans. Lucy's not shy, she's just...
Some guy falls asleep on your shoulder, what do? Just like, you know, he's sitting next to you, like, and then he just slides down and like...
Yeah, probably just like... Shoulder.
Yeah.
I just sort of gently push him onto the floor, face first, just...
I always think of, when I think of the shoulder scene, I always think of Shaun of the Dead when he's on the bus and the girl does that and he's just like, meh, and just flicks her head back up with his shoulder and he's like, you know.
No. Lucy would just be like,
poof. Yeah. Maybe put her feet up on top of him or something like that. Yeah.
Well, you know, just whatever.
All right. So we get the Far Cry sun coming up and going down thing. And, you know, We first go over to Nina's side of things, and we get a scene of maybe you're still in the bed and Paul is putting on his security guard outfit or like something equivalent of it, right? He's probably like putting on like a tactical belt and he's probably got like an underarm sling and he's got like maybe just like a military jacket or something like that he's putting on and he's just like... He sees you waking up and he's like, ah, so do I look the part? Am I homeless enough?
Even a little. Yeah. But I like that.
And he's like, ah, okay. All right.
Instead of I like that, I just say you look good.
All right. And he's like, well, hop to it. Maybe use the shower one last time. And then we gotta say goodbye to this old girl, I guess.
Nice digs. It's too bad.
Yeah, I'm sure we'll find something we can squat in. That's what you do, right? Squat?
Right. You know, if you can squat laying down.
Yes. He doesn't even shut the door behind him. You know, he just sort of like, fuck it. You know, I'm already in debt. What's going to happen? So he leaves. He's got a little, I guess, sort of like a, I want to say like a gym bag styles of like just clothes and maybe like a box of ammunition in there. And he's got like his gun. You know, he's got his mirror shades because he's a cop. That's what mirror shades have. They have to have mirror shades by default. And you know, he's got his toothpick and he's good to go. Where are you taking him, Nina? Queen of
the. Is he following me?
Yeah, he just sort of looks at you and he's just like, "All right, lead on."
Okay. So where is everybody else right now?
Most likely in the same place you left them. That's probably what your intuition says. You could also take him back to the Hoboken, which is like the other safe place that you would probably be aware of.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, I guess that's where I take him.
Hoboken?
I don't want to bring him to them because I'm not sure what the situation is back there. I mean, I walked out on them. I was angry. I was hurt. I was worried.
Yeah.
I was stressed, but I walked out on them. And mm-hmm. So I'm not really sure what the reception is. And I'm not even sure if I can go back to them, much less if I can bring someone. And I want to take him somewhere where he can stay and be as safe as a homeless person in Night City could be. So I'll take him there, yeah.
So as like, you know, you're walking to Hoboken, you probably walk past like a couple of TV shops where I can lay down some thick, nasty plot on you. So that's what I'm going to do. As you walk past like a TV repair station, shop or something like that, some sort of like used electronic, it's actually pawn shop. It's perfect. That's the one I'd use. As you're walking past a pawn shop, there's a TV playing in the window and it's got, you know, Mr. Melbonk. I hate saying this guy's fucking name, but it's the guy that's in the book. Mayor Mbol Eblanke.
Mbole Mbonke?
Yeah. Mbole Mbonke. I'm Australian, so that's how I'm going to say it. And he's on a talk show, like a morning talk show. And he's like on the show with like some presenter and they're like making muffins or something like that. You know, he's just like, and this is my family's recipe from Africa. And what I do is we put in rabbit stew and rabbit meat and we put it in with the mixture and it comes out perfect. And then the blonde curly haired, like frizzy haired 80s style presenter is just like, oh wow, that's amazing. But you know, I got someone talking in my ear. We need to ask you, Mr. Mayor, how is the homeless removal project coming along? And he's like, ah, funny you should mention that. We actually removed a hive not too long ago. And we cleanse that place with the only way that Night City police know how. And he just nods. And then we get like a scene, like a camera shot. It's like, here's some footage of the place you can see. And it's like your old settlement that you were in. And it has like guys like spraying it down with foam. Like, right? It's like, this place was actually used, can you believe it, to make drugs. Drugs that were sold to the citizens of Night City. Very poorly made, I might add.
Made fuck wine, thank you very much. Not drugs.
Yeah, and it's like,
as you can see, like Lucy's eye, like miles away from this, is just twitching. Yeah. Someone's.
Yeah, it shows like a close up of like a beaker or something like that that's like cracked and like burnt. And it's like, clearly they had many resources available to them. As you can see, very high tech.
They had no fucking beakers. What is this shit?
And
this
very, is an asshole. Very high tech, very futuristic drug capabilities of the.
I really, really want to put my foot through this asshole's brain.
Yeah, and
be like, so glorious.
So he's just the lady's just like, that's really scary. I have kids, and I don't want my kids getting anything from anyone on the street. He's like, well, maybe you shouldn't put your kid out on the street. It's very dangerous at the moment. That is why we're cleaning up the homeless, because the homeless are part of the problem. They are the problem. And then, like, and then it, like, an ad comes up. It's like, find out how Mayor Ebunke cooks his pancakes in the morning. And it's like, spoiler alert, it has rabbit in it. You know, like,
And then meanwhile, it cuts to an advert for Trump bars. Trump bars, only one euro book per 10.
Yeah, for a packet of 100.
You know. Maybe I just look at Paul and just like, I really fucking hate that guy.
And he's like, oh yeah, no, the mayor's real scummy. From what I've heard back from people who are on the force, it's just... They, apparently he rigs elections and everything. It's crazy.
Who's the runner-up? Like, is there something we could do about this? I mean, I know it's totally ridiculous to even think that we could actually do anything about anything, but I really want to kill this guy or just, like, rig it so he dies. Is that possible?
Funny,
and this is a pipe dream.
Yeah,
total
so,
pipe dream.
Yeah, he's just sort of, I'm like, kidding. He sits there, he scratches his chin, he's like, well, last I heard it was, you know, Richard Knight's kid. God, I can't remember his name. So weird that he's back, but apparently that's who he's running with. Or what he was running against at the time, but you know how it is. Mega corporations have the biggest vote in this city. And then it's just like a picture of him smiling. He's like, hey. He's like, here, I will show you the image that he has. Can you see that if I go like that? I don't want to show that. Oh, actually, I can. I'll show that. There you go. Can you see that?
Where?
Is that Denzel?
Yep. That is Denzel Washington.
With different hair?
Yes.
Is that Denzel with photoshopped hair?
Yes, it is. That is one of the most legitimate resources I can find for Night City, and that's what apparently he looks like. So, keep that in mind when you... when you see him. That's the mayor. There's a lot of shit behind him, so if you want to dig deep, you dig deep, because I've got documents upon documents about this motherfucker. So you're taking him to Hoboken, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so when you get there, you actually see it surrounded. There are police cruisers around there. And you actually see, like, a couple of, like, helmeted officers, like, tearing down, like, makeshift emplacements where the homeless used to be. And, like, maybe you see, like, a couple of people that you know, and they're just sort of arresting them for the most part.
Okay, so, I mean, at that point, I have no choice.
turning around.
Yeah, I mean, I literally, I'm walking and I stop short. It takes me like a second to see what's going on. Paul hasn't even realized that I've stopped yet. And I grab him and I'm like, let's go. I don't even say anything. I just pull him away. So, and he's like, what's going on? And I'm like, just follow me.
Yes.
And so at this point, I mean, I'm even more mad than I was before. I'm really fucking mad.
It's also worth pointing out that there is like a news crew there on the stage, on the scene as well. And the lady's, you know, reporting about how, so you see her before she goes like on air and she's just like, fucking Jason, get me in. What do I look like? Is my hair good? Like what's going on? And he's just like, yes, your hair is fine. Can we fucking do this, please? And she's just like, look, don't get fucking snippy at me. Look, I want to make sure that we get this right. This is the mayor's new thing. We got to make sure. He's like, okay, yes, you could probably use more lipstick, you fucking whore. And she's like, what did you call me? And she's like, nothing. I didn't call you anything. Can we do this fucking shot, please? And she's like, fine. Take 27. And then she's like... We're here on the scene with the mayor's new homeless cleanup act here in Night City. As you can see, we've found another hive, as the mayor is calling it, of scum and villainy. So far, the total of homeless people arrested in Night City is staggering. It's climbing up over to the 200 mark. What they're doing with these inflated homeless in the jails, no one's really knowing, but it's safe to assume that they are no longer going to be hitting up Night City streets with drugs and sexual deviancy. More okay, at nine.
So here's my question. I mean, at this point, like everything that Nina has chosen to make these people her family.
Basically. Oh yeah. The people at Hoboken? Yeah.
The people at Hoboken and her actual crew. Like these are her people now. They've been her people for a little while now. These are the people that sort of took her in after everything she went through, and so she cares about them, and she's just tired of being walked on. And she's been, you know, she's been through fucking shit, and now these people are being thrust into more shit that they've already had to deal with for all their lives. And it's just, she just can't take it. She just can't fucking take it anymore. So she just turns to Paul and is like, this is like the straw that breaks the camel's back, so to speak. She's just like, did you mean what you said about you were capable? About how capable you think you are?
So he like sees this glint in your eye and he's like, do not fire upon the police. Please do not do this.
Look, not stupid, Paul. Come on.
What are you going to do then? You going to slash their tires? Like what?
I don't know yet, but there are some people that might have some better ideas than me that I sort of trust. So let's go there.
I tell you what, I'm with you as long as we think about things. None of this rash action, okay?
We're definitely on the same page when it comes to that.
Oh, Paul's wearing the trousers in this relationship.
Yeah, I mean, the rash act, like, to give you an idea, rash action got him homeless, and it sure as fuck is not going to get him extra homeless. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, and I like that. I'm tired of the reckless fucking bullshit too.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, reckless fucking bullshit got by where she was, I think that we have enough skill and enough talent amongst us to overcome that. And I'm pissed enough about everything, and I kind of believe in Paul enough about everything. And about this, we're on the same page. Like, I believe in Paul in so much as I believe in his ability to accomplish things, you know, at the very least. Like, I may not, like, I kind of see, you know, like, maybe I could trust him with more someday. But
maybe,
you know, that's a whole other thing, right? There's trusting that he's a capable dude, and I trust that. I've seen that, and him saying that, even like, don't be reckless, him saying that to me makes me trust him more, because that's exactly what Vi did, and what everyone has done kind of. But like, some of these people do know their shit and do have connections, and our fixer, for example, you know, they might have ideas of something we could do. They might not even know this is happening in Hoboken. The mayor is like going after us now.
So
we need to do something, but we need to do something smart. And so I'm angry enough about everything that I'm going to go back to them with Paul and be like, we need to do something. I'm just going to like pretend Vi's not there, kind of.
Okay. So you guys move over to the where you came from. So basically the docks, you know, and Paul for the most part is just going along. He's just sort of wondering where you're taking him, but eventually it becomes clear when he sees the rest of your crew and the now outfitted pimp mobile that he did his crime in. And I assume, Lucy, you're like elbows deep in this car at the moment trying to fix it. Maybe with the help, well, maybe you're like sort of directing some of the,
I'm probably just sort of like trying to help some sort of like, I'm kind of hovering around some large dude who's elbow deep. Just, oh, and then, how about that? Yeah. Yes.
So, and he's just sort of, maybe he leans on the car and he gets up and he's like, look, I'm helping you because You threw a pretty good party last night. I don't need you over my shoulder telling me what the fuck I'm supposed to do all the time.
I like to imagine that, like, depending on where he is, like, maybe just an arm falls down, his box is just passed out, and it's just like his arm falls over on top of his head. He's just like...
I mean, he's fixing the car. Like, he's in the front of the car fixing it, you know, like...
Okay, so maybe there's just, like, a thunk on the thing. It's just his hand falls off the top of the roof because he's just fell asleep on top of the van.
Yeah, okay.
How did he even get up?
Oh, I put him up there last night. Pretty funny, huh?
So, maybe... do you even have a shirt anymore, Hal? Or are you just walking around, like, completely
shirtless? No, he lost his shirt sometime last night. I gotta go find it. Yeah. I mean, it's pretty... It's gonna be hard to miss.
Yeah.
Pretty raw big. Boxes at the top of the tied to his head.
So, I like to imagine that Vi, you fell asleep surrounded by, like, just cigarette butts. And
sounds about right.
The only reason why you went to sleep is because your packet ran dry. You know, like, we got a scene of you last night where you just, like, you know, you're literally, like, lighting a cigarette with another cigarette, you know, like, chain smoking it, and
chain smoking.
You go to, like, pull out the last one, you go the, you know, the tap the bag, the box, and nothing comes out, and he's like, oh fuck, you know, like maybe you scrunch it up, throw it across the thing, and then, like, we get that, like, a stop cut of, like, it was dark and now it's night, daytime, and you're sort of waking up at this point, and you look over and see the scrunched up, like, you know, cigarette box that you threw earlier, and you're instantly reminded of the shit that you went through previously. Have you come to any sort of, like epiphany or anything like that during your...
No, I think she's gone through... basically her past, shit that's happened to her that's directly related to this.
Yeah, yeah.
Because she's trying to find out why Nina is mad at her, because she really, like, truly, she doesn't actually understand.
Yeah. I mean, all I did was get trained. So, yeah. You hear Nina talking to someone. Nina, what are you talking to someone about? Probably Lucy at this point. Maybe, like, reintroducing Paul at this point to them or something like that. You're muted, by the way.
Muted. You're muted. Still muted.
Sorry. Pro streamer. Super pro
streamer.
she's just being like, hey, remember that guy that saved our bacon? He's homeless now because of us.
But
he's really good at what he does, and yeah, he's kind of, you know.
So yeah, let me reintroduce Paul for everyone who doesn't know what he looks like. He is basically this brown, curly-haired man, like really curly-haired, like fucking
like the floof or more.
No, like short curly hair sort of thing. Like,
gotcha.
You know, he's wearing like these bright orange mirror shades, and he's got a toothpick in his mouth, and he outstretches a hand, and he's basically got like these like they're essentially shooting gloves on, and he outstretches a hand to you, Hal, and he's like, I'm in your care then.
Right. Quick word of advice: lose the shades. You look like a cop. You don't want to be a cop around here.
Good point.
He sort of like looks around and is just like, but I am a cop.
No, you're a hired muscle.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, so he'll take off the shades and he'll like put them into his like front pocket, and he'll like squint at you and he'll be like, it's really bright out here.
You'll get used to it. Keep the toothpick. Rest. Yeah, you're pretty high quality muscle. Just remember that.
Maybe lose the badge and the jacket that says SWAT.
it's probably
he doesn't have a badge on, right?
No, he doesn't have a badge.
Oh, it's probably the same.
It's probably like the same jacket that you're thinking of, except it's got that Velcro strip on it, and he's just removed like the word on it, and it's still got the Velcro strip on the back there. So
he could have lifted it. You know, that's fine.
Yeah, like the chinos guy.
Yeah.
I'm kind of imagining Paul to be like one of those guys who's like kind of self-absorbed, so he might have like this really custom leather jacket on, right, that has Paul on the back where it like, would say SWAT or something like that.
Yeah, so that's what he looks like, in case you guys
can. Right. I'm gonna walk over to Voxel and sort of slap him awake, and while I'm doing that, I'm just gonna take his cigarettes out of his pocket.
Damn.
Lifted.
And when you wake up, I'm gonna be like, cigarette.
I need to give you a quick once over medically when you've got a minute as well, just to make sure there's no, you know, just
Henley, does Vox freak out with a 10 on cool?
No, 10 is the basic DC for everything, so.
Perfect. Okay, he wakes up and he's just like, whoa, party. Yeah, whoa, dude. I remember.
Cigarette.
He just like takes a pack and just like tosses at you. He's like, whoa, hey, Nina, you're back as well. Oh.
So what's the plan then? I mean,
plan for what?
You don't just exist, right? You have a plan to get out of the slums, yeah?
First off, Voxel, give me my shirt back.
Oh, yeah, sorry, dude.
Big ass bandana.
Second, as soon as he's done fixing the car, we're going to see if we can get ourselves some work, earn some cash, find us a place to stay. Not squat.
Just to interject, you guys are aware that the mayor is fucking gunning for us and is decimating Hoboken.
What do you mean?
What? What's going on?
Yeah, Hoboken is gone. Cops are all over it. Press is all over it. The mayor has basically stated on the news that he is out for our blood. I'd like to do something about that. How about you guys?
What's his rationale?
We should leave the city. Mm.
Well, I mean, we could easily.
Where the fuck would we go? We don't know anybody anywhere else.
Well, this is our home. Family out there somewhere, thank you very much. Bastards.
If you guys can your family feed all of us? Can your family even feed you? Why did you leave in the first place? Why aren't you there right now?
I didn't leave. I was, they moved on without me.
So, right. Anyway, what can we do about this situation here?
Fine. They need me.
Well,
just kill that asshole.
Wait. Paul, dude.
You want to assassinate them?
What is his modus operandi?
I'm sorry, I don't speak Spanish.
It means his motive, basically. His the way he. So what I've learned about all of this is that he's literally ejecting homeless. He's arresting them, and I'm not sure what he's doing with them, because that would cost a lot more money than he's probably willing to put. So my best bet is that he's arresting them and shipping them to another state. Most likely.
Could just be selling them for organs and limbs and things. I mean, that's what I'd do.
Yeah, that's fucking disgusting.
What do you mean?
What are we gonna do about it? Economically, that's my question.
Welcome to the streets, Paul.
Yeah. No. So
he, like, why does his would color you store up, these like... people or something? Yeah. Why would you store these people? There's perfectly good limbs going begging. God.
Why don't we just give all the homeless people guns?
Well, no. Where's the like what is it called? The appeal for it, right? He has to have some backing to do this, some way to get, like, the rabble-rousers up and going.
Well, it's probably his financial backers, most likely.
Ah. Is this the dude who just, like scummed through a bunch of elections and shit like that?
I mean, he's been the mayor for as long as I've had a job, so...
How do we hurt their bottom line? That'll make them stop backing him, and then he can just fuck off.
We're not gonna do shit to a corp, baby. We're not gonna do shit.
I mean, you don't got the manpower.
We gotta do something that makes them turn away from helping him. I mean, we can't hurt them, right? What? But we've gotta hurt something in some way that makes them stop helping him.
Well, what's he doing for the corpse? If you stop him from doing that, then why would they give him money?
I mean, your guess is as good as mine.
Are you people insane? You're talking about going up against the mayor of Night City.
Honestly, Nina, right now, what we should be focusing on is not, you know, getting the mayor, but we should be focusing on getting stable living so that we don't become another fatality of the mayor's regime.
Exactly.
Oxel is gonna like lean down off the top of the van, open the door, honk the horn a couple times. He's like, "We're fine. We got a car."
Yeah, I suggest we just.
Thanks for your input, picket fence.
I suggest we just mosey on out of Night City for a few weeks until this all blows over.
We don't have anywhere to go. We don't have anywhere to go, and he's after us specifically.
No, he's not.
After us specifically.
What? No, he's not. Shut up.
Yeah, he is.
Hold on. Did he call us out by name? Do we have wanted posters?
I'm pretty sure I'm sinless.
West Warrant?
I don't know, but I don't think that we can just lay low and we have nowhere else to go. And honestly, I'm sick and tired of doing nothing. I'm sick and tired of doing bullshit.
What makes you think he's after us, though? That's stupid. We're nobodies.
Well, no. What she's going at is that our place got trashed. Hoboken got trashed.
We have nowhere else to go.
Out of
anything we do, we're going to get fucked.
We have a mobile transportation and we can just leave.
Don't you think any other city is going to be better than this piece of shit?
Yeah,
I assume that every other city is not having
at least we know this city. Cops. At least we know what happens here.
Cops and nomads don't get along too well. That's why nomads stay out on the roads in big vans and convoys, right? So two, going to your point, Nina, there's a couple of ways to attack a big figure. One, descend. See if there's not some way to get the people working for him angry at him. Maybe we could do that. Two, humiliation. Who knows? Maybe we could just like kidnap him, make him homeless, make him live like homeless for a while. Some other rickshaw will step into his place. I'd be down for that.
That is such a dumb idea. I love it. I hope you guys pick that. It's like, all right, let's kidnap the mayor and let's force him to drink toilet wine and poop in the streets.
If Paul had said that it was a crackdown on drugs, that was going to be my first suggestion. Make him get addicted to toilet wine.
So
I mean, I'd be down with that. I don't care if the plan is crazy. I just want a plan.
So yeah, Paul will
we
look
can at, enact.
Paul will look over at you, Hal, and be like, "You know people, right? That's your job."
I have a few friends in the right places.
Do you know anyone who can, I don't know, get us in touch with a corp to run street deals or anything like that?
I do know a friend of mine I owe a favor to. That might give us a foot in the door.
Well, the only thing that I can think of that, you know, help whatever you're trying to run, Nina, and help us establish an income is to get into the back pocket of a corp and maybe work our way up from that.
So, I don't know if you noticed where we are, but we also do have some connections to some just street-level gangs. We could also roam around doing that to that. All depends on which kind of bullet you want to take. You want to get one out of an Uzi or one out of a rifle?
I know a corp, y'all.
I'm just going to ignore what Vi says. I'm still I think we should.
Absolutely horrified by, you know, all of this.
I love you, Lucy, but I'm going to ignore what you have to say too.
Lucy's
all right, Hal. So, what like kind of context do you have that can give us some roots to hurting the mayor? Nina needs some negative thing to focus on. She's mad at Vi. She's mad at everything right now. She wants Paul to be in a better situation because she feels bad because she feels like she put him in the situation that he's in. But she's also pissed at him for allowing her to do that. She doesn't know what the fuck to do with herself or these people. And she knows that they're all in trouble and that this man is after them.
Fucked up.
Yeah, she is. Very. And so she just wants to like hurt someone. And the mayor seems like the best target. So she wants some end game. She wants some end game where he can be hurt that maybe gets them in a better situation right now.
So, Nina, from what you told me, the mayor seems to be not specifically targeting us, but all of the homeless in general in this area.
I think, honestly, that he knows who we are and he knows that we're a little bit more capable. I'll look at Paul.
So I'm just going to step in as a GM right now. That's almost impossible that he would know about you guys personally. Okay. I think what it's just a he's using your burned out house, and I can see why you might think that that might be a connection, but he was simply using your burned out house as, you know, look, rich people, at what I'm doing as mayor. Look what we found. And, you know, he's using whatever evidence he can to prove that he's doing something.
Yeah, but, that's what it seemed like. That was his first, like, that was their first success. And yeah. So that's what they're inflating the crap out of.
Yeah. So to give you a point, though, Hal, for example, mm-hmm. if you wanted to go down this route, if you all decide that this is the sort of stuff that you want to, you know, look into doing, there is ways to do that. For example, you don't necessarily have to know someone in the business of selling guns or running guns or doing that sort of stuff. You could know someone from a media angle, for example, who's looking to make a scoop on this, and you're generating a scoop by doing things. She might fund that, or he might fund that, you know? Like, that's the sort of stuff that Night City is. Night City is a very scummy place. You can very easily find people in every walk of life, be that from a you know, big pharma corporation, or be that from I need to make a story, or be that from someone who's literally doing gun stuff. Like, it doesn't necessarily have to be violence the way that you focus on this stuff. But for example, let's say, you know, you talk to a media and you say, okay, we want to get the scoop on what the mayor's really doing. And then you spend time like tailing the mayor and finding out the dirt on the mayor and maybe trying to get a little deeper and then selling that information to like other press members and stuff like that. There are ways that you can hurt this man that doesn't necessarily mean shooting his bodyguards and putting needles inside of him or something, whatever you want to do.
Sounds like a lot of
fun. Tempting as that would be. I'd be okay with that. I just want to do some damage. Yeah, I'm mad and I want to do some damage.
There are plenty of ways. Think of every single movie you've ever seen. Think of every sort of blackmail movie you've ever seen. Think of every sort of revenge movie.
Let's go Ocean's 11 on this motherfucker.
So exactly, right? I mean, we have the capacity and the intelligence as adults and human beings to come up with a very interesting plot and connection to this guy. Because let me tell you right now, and I'm going to give you guys this for a freebie. This mayor, he is prime real estate, prime rib. He is fucking the best cut of beef. If you want to fucking make a story in Night City, and I tried to do it in the last one, but it didn't really stick because everyone was focused on their internal stuff. But this mayor, you can take him down so many pegs. You just got to be a little creative in how you do it.
Right.
Hal, you think you can find out where his money comes from?
Let's give our old friend Vixen a call. Maybe she can do something for us.
Maybe she can fix it. We've known her like 2 weeks or something.
A lot longer than that. It's more like.
She doesn't say anything because she thinks it's a good idea, but she's pissed that Vi came up with it. She's mad at Vi.
Lucy, you caught set in the scene. Read the mood.
Come on. But it's inaccurate.
You should have seen the way she quivered as soon as you gave her all that stack of cash. She knows she can make money from it. She's going to hop on it. Like, sorry, inappropriate joke coming out there.
So my idea here is we find out who's backing him. We find out who's against these backers. We get in bed with these backers. We work our way up the chain. We work their back room side and do the dirty work they don't have people to do.
You know, actually, I'm wondering now. We sent the kids to Hoboken, didn't we?
Yes, we did.
I wouldn't worry about them too much.
Ah, well, poor Mungo. Wasn't very good anyway.
Despite the hands, I got kind of a connection to Lisp. I gave him that Lisp, and he went through it in strides, man. Paul, brother, blood is stronger than, like, water or some shit like that. I don't know. Do you know if you could use any of your connections to see if you can't figure out where these paddy wagons are hauling off to?
Look, man, I run security.
He just looks like a cop.
I'm very good at looking like a cop.
He's just a rent-a-cop.
I'm a little more than a rent-a-cop, but...
You're a rent-a-cop, let's face it.
In terms of connections, the only things that I've got are retired old fucks from the force.
So
might they have any connections? Can we get like a pet, like a string of shit going
on? Yeah, let me just... Hey, George, do you know anything about some orphans that got taken away in the mayor's new beatdown in Night City? Let me check.
I think
to see
the
if someone
only
on the
thing we can do for
that.
These orphans is help take down this mayor. If we take down the mayor, some other dude is going to come into the office and he's going to release half the prisoners because it'll look good to pardon everybody. And kids are going to be the first one among them because that looks pretty on camera.
And who knows? Oh, maybe no, these kids didn't even get caught. I mean, if I was a kid in this city running around still alive, I'd be pretty resourceful.
Paul and I didn't see any of them when we were there when people were getting hauled off.
Yeah, they would have done a runner if they, you know, they're not going to be hanging around going, "Ooh, no."
Yeah, you're right. I did teach them well.
Okay. Well, too much talking. Somebody make a fucking phone call.
All right, so I will call Vixen.
All right, yeah. And I think that's a good place to break.
Fearless metal-infused heroes have some out-of-character disgusting to discuss.
Excuse me, I'm completely unmodified.
So is Voxel.
I mean...
We should fix that.
Yeah, me too.
You guys aren't the heroes of the story.
So. Wow.
I'm just a fucking doctor, okay? I'm just a fucking doctor.
I play doctor like on every other role-playing show.
Yeah. So you guys have a couple options here. A really good idea came up to use the backstory of one Halana Kalanani.
Close enough.
To...
I think my name's actually harder to pronounce than Tess's.
Fine. That's because Tess is really easy to pronounce.
Yeah. So using your backstory, I think, would be really cool.
Shall I elaborate?
Yes, please elaborate.
Okay, so for those who don't know or just new joiners, Hal is a pirate. He's been grown up a pirate his entire life. The Skulldusk is his crew, part of his crew. His parents were in charge of it.
Pirates, we mean robbing shipping container ships, like holding them up at gunpoint, taking ill-gotten goods and getting the bug away.
And, I believe my parents they're out of the picture for undisclosed means. I believe I said they were arrested when I made the character. Yeah. So, oh, yes, they were in a conspiracy and were arrested. And throughout his having to, you know, be a pirate, Hal himself came across they decided to rob a cruise ship at one point. And Stockholm Syndrome, the daughter of the executive, fell in love with Hal, and he, being a pirate at the time, rejected her. He's like, "No, go back home. You don't belong with me," or whatever. And she was rather tiffed at that. And
no. Just real quickly,
we cannot be together.
Did you have any physical relationship with her at all? Did you hit it and quit it?
I hit it and quit it.
All right.
Because Hal is...
did you have any relations with that woman?
Did you practice coitus with her?
I did. I didn't practice. I nailed it.
Literally.
She was...
That was accidental fun.
She was a piece of wood and you were a hammer with a nail.
Yep. How did I describe Hal before? He is a man who doesn't say no. Most of the time.
Until he's like, done.
He'll say meh, but he won't say no.
Okay. So you had this relationship with this executive's daughter. Now, did we say how far up the totem pole the executive was?
We did not. We just said it was an executive.
I remember it being like a fairly reasonably medium-sized thing.
Field booster, no. Not all I have written down is daughter of executive.
Okay. So there's that potential angle we can explore as cool guys on the internet and girls. Peachy included. the other option is Hal can potentially try and negotiate his contacts to see if he can work a media angle. Find someone in the media, probably around a shit kicker level, to see if you guys can drum up some bad press for El Presidente. There was another option floating about. Does anyone have any more options?
Well, I just...
Get the fuck out now, you see?
We could run away.
You eating fish sticks?
Just straight up walking up to him and shooting him in the face.
Apricots.
There's that.
Yes,
And then there's also trying to organize a revolution with a bunch of the gangs.
That would almost be impossible. There are so many feud wars and territory disputes going on that would be...
The other one was arm the homeless.
What?
So yeah. Basically go to the gangs and say, take in these battered wretches and turn them into warriors.
Do you guys remember how hard it was for you guys to obtain guns? And you guys are like PCs. You have special powers when it comes to fucking finding what you want.
Let's face it. If we give the homeless people guns, they're just going to fucking sell them for toilet wine or whatever. Hey, a gun. Cool.
Well, see, isn't that brilliant, you know, circular economy? We give them guns. They buy toilet wine with the guns. We get the guns back. We give them to other homeless people. They buy more toilet wine.
Selling.
Yeah, we're just getting the same guns back. I don't understand where the profit is. We're basically giving them guns.
They get other guns to get more toilet wine.
Where do they get the guns from?
Exactly.
Easier to get money.
They don't grow on trees, you know.
They don't have gun trees in Night City?
You have to go outside to the gun orchids to find the gun trees. So.
Oh, okay.
So I like the idea of exploring Hal's backstory a little more. Oh. I like that method.
Yeah? What do you guys think? Let's take a vote.
Also, Hal rolls like a beast. So I'm done with that.
I think that'd be cool because I'm pretty sure that going into Mafia territory... it's a bad idea. Sticking with the gangs, bad idea.
I'm in the Civil War. That's a great idea.
Well, no, I think it'd be fun as all get out to try and organize that, trying to get everybody together.
Yeah, that would probably most likely flop because it'd be like, "What, man? What? What do you want me to?" Fuzzy, where do you fall on this line? What would you like to do?
Lucy just wants to get the fuck out of Night City, but if everybody is gonna do something else, she'll probably go along with it. But just.
Peer pressure.
I'm not talking about Lucy. I'm talking about what Fuzzy wants to do.
Oh, well. Out of character? I think the corporate route is probably the best one.
Yeah, the backstory then?
Yeah.
You just
want to
play Astrid again, don't you?
I really want to meet Astrid really badly.
Wow. Okay. So
you're not a guy.
Yeah. Maybe you're all like thinking or whatever. And Hal, you get this lightning bolt of inspiration. Wasn't there that that weird floozy that just wouldn't stop fucking hanging onto your inner pocket? That one time on that cruise ship?
Yeah, that's right. What was her name again? Oh, crap. That's really important to remember her name, at least. How many years ago was that? It's only like 5 years ago.
A mole on her left butt cheek.
Mole quick
butt. I need a mole butt
in the shape of a dog
if you look at it from the right angle.
It was your favorite style too.
Oh, sex joke
in Night City, unheard of.
Okay, so
how do you think?
Yeah.
How would I go about contacting her again?
I mean, you probably have her number somewhere.
You got it tattooed on your dick.
No, there's other names on there. It's not even names. There's like tabby marks.
What?
Surely it's more like
the four lines with one going across.
Surely at this point it's just cross hatching, because you know.
Tabby marks? Like a cat?
No, tally marks.
I thought he said tabby, as in like a tabby cat.
He's a bit of a goer, so it's just going to be like, you know, cross-hatch.
Jesus Christ.
Cross-hatching.
Yeah, great. Self-mutilation on a muscle that's completely made out of blood. That'll go well.
Penis is not a muscle.
It is if you work out enough.
You could probably, scour your mind to find this number. If not, potentially you might have an ex, contact that you used to work with who might remember her. Or?
Oh, yeah, that's right. I have a fence. I believe her name is T. She might have. Yeah, literally her name was T. Just
Let's take a look at what we actually got here, because I've got some notes here. I have Red, Fixer, Mr. Smiles, Social Engineer, and HD, a cyberware black market dealer. I don't have T, though. Oh, wait, no. T as female street level contact. Fence. You also have Skulldusk.
The Skulldusk Pirates was, me a favor. Oh, I thought I was the Skulldusk.
All right. I actually have her name here, which is great.
Yeah, so she might have had, this house still hasn't remembered a name. I haven't come up with it.
I have the name written down.
Of the daughter?
Yep, that name.
She would have slipped a paper with her name and number on it somewhere on me when I was leaving. And then, going to tea, my fence, giving her the goods I'm selling, purse, which watch, whatever. And then, paper, like, the fuck, I don't need that. So T has it.
I just like to think that, like, you dumped off an old phone with it and she's still texting the phone and talking with her, and they're just like best gal friends right now.
That'd be kind of cool. I'll call up T.
All right, yeah, exactly 3 rings go past.
I forward the voicemail, aren't I?
And she picks up.
Oh.
She's like eating a bowl of cereal in the land. Is that you, Hal?
Hey, T, how's it going?
I should find where you are and shoot you.
You probably should. Hey, I got a favor to ask you.
You always go want something from me.
Exactly. So you remember a few years ago when
I remember a few years ago how you fucked me out of 10 grand? No. Who could forget that?
I did do that. I'll make it up to you. I remember it was a loan. I'll give it back to you. You remember that cruise ship? There was a daughter on there. She is daughter of exec, some big wig.
Who could forget that skank?
Yeah, I need her number.
You hear her, put down, the spoon inside the bowl. and she's just like, oh, do you just now?
Yeah, you see, I've been reflecting on my life lately. I'm trying to make amends with everyone in my past.
How about you make amends with me in your past and give me my fucking 10 Gs?
That's why I need her number, because I'm trying to earn an honest living. I'm hanging up the fixer life. I am going straight and narrow. But first, I need her name.
Wait, is she going to be your sugar mama?
That's the idea.
You're working something here, Hal. I can smell it. Are you going to shift her?
No, why would I ever do that?
Come on, Hal.
Did I ever tell you no too much, T?
I'll take 30%.
30? You know, I got other people work with me on this one, T. I can do you 20.
20, but the first 10 G is mine.
All right. I can't do this without you, T.
All right. Let me text Susan real quick. You hear her, like, pull up the phone. And
Susan!
Pal's like, Susan, I knew it!
I knew it started with an S.
Yeah. And it's just like, oh, yeah, she remembers you. Oh, the texts are coming. I can barely keep up with Rich. Oh, my God. Hal.
Uh-huh.
You might want to buy some flowers.
Yeah, probably I should take a shower too.
Maybe two, if you have to say that. You might be used to your own, you know. I've told her to meet you. Do you know a good restaurant? Where are you right now? I'm assuming NC.
Yeah, I'm at a friend's place.
Okay, well, she's a, you know, rich white girl. She's gonna want to eat nice.
Find me something under 200 euro bucks.
I said nice, Hal.
I know.
Fine, McDonald's. I'll tell him McDonald's.
Is this like a, is this Demolition Man? Taco Every Bell. Restaurant is McDonald's.
It's probably McDougal's at this point.
McDougal's?
Yeah.
Is that a Coming to America reference?
Yeah.
I think a little bit.
You know me too well, Peachy. Can we just like marry and fuck already? All right, hang on. Let me find.
I mean, I'm okay. I'm down for the second part, but not the first part.
Okay. Well, I mean, I wanted to put a ring on it, but that's all right. No. So let's see here. I'll find you something real quick. I mean, because this is the thing about Night City. There is so much. Let's see. City overview. Okay. What are we looking for? No, we don't need that. We don't need parking. We don't need taxis. We don't need vehicle rentals. We don't need the department call boxes for police. We don't need automotive. We don't. Oh, we might need media. I'll keep that in mind. What else we got? We don't need the airport. We don't need bus schedules. Let's see.
I mean, I might need the bus schedule. Am I going to have lots of dropping off like my dad? Have fun, son.
Yeah. Oh man, there's a bunch of museums and shit you guys can go to. I'll have to do a gunfight in a museum pretty soon. That's kind of cool. Yeah. Let's see. Hotel lodgings, no. Clubs and nightlife, here we go. Let's see. Ooh. El Strange Nightclub. Nice. I like it. That's where you're going to go.
Do they serve the vintage?
It's actually a gastro pub.
Yeah.
Do they sell toilet wine?
Fucking gastro pubs.
I hope their wine cellar is full of toilet wine.
Yeah, no, it won't be.
Damn.
So you'll be like taking a sip of wine and just like, just missing like so much. So
like,
you can barely taste the bleach.
It's not burning my sinuses. What is this?
it's not dissolving the outer layer of my teeth.
So you would
pussy wine.
You know the El Estrange nightclub. It's you know what? Fuck it. We'll do the Sunset Bar and Grill. It's easier to say. It's right next to the nightclub, so you can take it there afterwards. So you good?
Yeah.
So she'll meet you there, Hal, and I hope you haven't lost weight. You had a good figure. She like hangs up.
Yeah, so I'm just like, Hal has notably skinnier since he came to Night City. He's like, food and those Trump bars really don't stick to your ribs, do they?
Yeah, they make you lose weight like crazy. Okay, great. So, what's everyone else going to do to prepare? So, we've got Hal meeting an estranged lover. Is anyone else doing anything? Like, maybe you guys try and find a place to set up the toilet wine stuff? Maybe find a place to squat in or something like
what
that?
What was the mayor's name?
The mayor's name is...
Robert Mugabe.
No. Mayor Imbola Bunke.
I'm carving that into a magnum bullet.
Wow.
Oh, that's what... I was wondering... Okay, so I have his name written on my sheet here, and all it said is like, Imbola... It looks like I put embalm a monkey. I was like, that can't be right.
Embalm a monkey.
You guys are going to laugh when you realize why it's like that. It's a great story. Anyway, please.
Is it embalm?
It's not anagram, is it? I was going to say, yeah. Lucy will probably be trying to work out how to set up a mobile toilet wine manufactory sort of distillery type thing.
I don't know if you've ever tried to do a distillery before, but need to...
Yo, Breaking Bad. Jesse, we have to cook.
Yes, but a distillery requires things being still.
It's toilet wine. It needs stirring or the lumps congeal.
Okay, fair enough. I will give you that. How much do you want to make?
Not a lot right now because we have limited resources and, you know, we might have to move soon, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm just trying to try and get like a small batch done just to, you know, just to keep
all
per
right.
the,
you need, as per normal, you need about $1,000 Eurobucks of down payment to get started.
For a small batch?
I mean, $1,000 made 92 bottles, so...
Didn't you just make $1,000? You made absolutely no profit on the last.
You made negative $200.
Look,
negative $100. Sorry, yeah.
Lucy isn't a numbers person, okay? Lucy is very much not.
Ah, damn it! I just said I was going to be her bookkeeper and keep track of all her overhead, and now I left.
Okay, so yeah. Okay, so Lucy's going to go out and. You know, try and get the
source some cold medicine.
Yeah. Well, what she'll probably do actually is go to the gang and just be like, yes. Who's the leader?
Hammer.
Hammer. I was just wondering. You know that delicious wine that you bought off me. Well, I'm looking to make another batch, and I was just wondering. You know, maybe you could send some of your lads out to round up some ingredients for it because
Paul and I will help.
Gotta get cooking.
I really want to get away from everyone else.
Okay, so he'll look at you and he'll be like, he'll smile and be like, I tell you what, you give me a piece of that pie, that might help you.
It's wine, not pie.
He'll literally roll his eyes.
I just pat Lucy on the head, and I'm like, and then I smile at Paul. And I'm like, it'll be okay.
Don't patronize me.
I tell you what, I'll let you do all the cooking, all that sort of stuff. We'll handle setup 60-40.
In whose favor?
Our favor, of course. All you have to do is. Distill. The wine will be ours. You'll make a nice little cut.
Okay, but I hold the recipe.
Oh my god, we're doing it. This is Breaking Bad now, but with fucking toilet wine. Let's go. It's happening. Yes, all right. Yes,
You can handle the distribution and things then, because quite frankly, it's a bother.
Yeah, so he'll stick out his hand and be like,
Lucy just pulls on a rubber glove and then shakes his hand. Hygiene.
See, like, you've hugged. And I just look at her and I'm like, Lucy, You've literally been inside with your hands and stitched me up and all sorts of weird shit.
Yes, and I was wearing gloves.
Yeah, but we also shared some of this wine between us, and he's been everywhere. So just deal with it, girl.
Yeah. Okay. Behind you. So he'll like.
You don't know what he was doing with those hands last night. I saw what he was doing last night.
Mm-hmm. So he'll be like, okay, so what do you need?
Okay, well, I'll need about $1,000 worth of, let's see, it was cold and flu remedy and some toilet duck and a little bit.
I forgot you put that in there. I forgot that you put that shit in there.
Menthol, you know, any kind of
ethanated alcohol.
Yeah, half a glass of cherry for taste.
Yeah.
It's a toothpaste. This, that, you know.
Powerball tablets.
Pretty much, yeah. A bit of baking soda.
It is like, okay, all right. Ingredients are one thing, but what about... What about equipment?
Oh yes. I'll need a number 3 retort and
the biggest beaker you can find.
Yeah, bucket, speakers, if you can get a sieve or coffee filters would be perfect. Or socks if you can't get coffee filters.
Urinals.
Urinals? Well, you mean urinals?
Urinals?
Yes, you call
them urinals. The urinals.
Guys, it's urine.
Yeah, urinals.
Urine. You say urine, I say urine.
Yeah.
We say urine, but we say
you urinal. You say brain or brine.
Oh my god, we're not doing this. You say
tomato
wrong.
Or tomato?
Dear.
So he will note down everything that you want. And, you know, over the course of the next coming day or so, he'll put it together for you. And he'll kind of sort of expect you to work it as well, since he's investing in this business opportunity. Investing.
What I'll probably do is I won't then set it up in the van. I will set it up in, like, you know, I'm assuming they've got like a side room somewhere. I'll set it up there, because what I'm thinking is if the police do bust the thing, I could just, you know, I've still got the recipe, so I can just, you know, yeah. Oh, look, these bad guys have been brewing the toilet wine. These are obviously the bad guys
What's your special? Is it chili powder? Is that what you put in the meth? I mean the toilet wine?
No, I think it's the toilet duck is the
the toilet duck. Get the blue one. It has to be the blue one.
It has to be the blue one, yeah.
It has to be the blue one. Yeah, okay, so you'll get everything. What is everyone else doing? I mean, I assuming that you're helping. And, you know, in a lot of cases, what's happening is these people, they're not, like, going into stores and buying them. They're robbing these fucking stores. Hmm. Like, they're, like, straight up balaclavas, like, fucking punching the store clerk in the face.
Hey, it's more efficient than the kids.
Yep. And just taking everything that they want, right? Hmm. What's going to be a result of this, though, is that sort of stock is going to be harder and harder to get in that city, because they'll start putting behind lock and cage if they keep getting robbed for the same stuff, you know, which will eventually happen, but just a heads up on that. Mm-hmm. AKA let's follow the same story of Breaking Bad to the T. Yeah.
Do I get to throw a pizza on a roof at some point?
I mean, I imagine fucking Nina and Paul will eventually have a falling out. They'll have a kid together who'll be crippled. And you know, he'll have some problems growing up, and you know, Nina will
lots of no there.
Nina will become a teacher teaching PE at a high school, she'll get cancer, and then she'll have to go into the business again that she got out of in order to make money for her family. It's a sad story. Oh my god.
Fuck all that shit.
Alright, so perfect, yeah. Now, the last scene before we go on our final break is, you know, we get the camera from over the shoulder of this, I don't know, what's a good hair color?
Pink.
Red.
Oh, shit.
Purple.
Yeah. All right, she's
pink,
got
red, purple.
She's got like pink, red, fucking purple. Highlights in every direction of all these colors that were just mentioned in her hair. And we get a camera over the shoulder, and she's just like, "Suck at the singer." Oh. And you're just sitting there, like maybe you got a little bow tie on or something like that. And maybe you're eating like
a tiny little one,
and maybe you're eating like a fish or something like that. This is like, I really like the tapas here. And she's like, you know, foot under
the table. She took off a tapas.
Jesus foot Christ. Under the table, like in your crotch, you know, like,
mm-hmm.
like so, shoes on the ground sort of thing. And you're just like, and she's like chewing on gum or whatever. And the guy drops, comes by and is like, puts like 12 oysters in front of her. And she's just like, you know, she's like,
me personally, I can't handle oysters. That's just me personally.
Yeah. And she's just like, do you feel it, Hal? And she like starts to screw her foot into your crotch a little bit. And
he's like, yeah, I really like this place. It's nice.
Yeah. And we'll leave it there when she like with the sound of her slurping down a oyster to ew. The fade of black.
Can we quickly cut to Vi putting the bullet with the mayor's name into a little case that's got four other bullets and two empty shell casings?
What are the four other bullets?
You'll have to find out.
Oh my god, plot.
Alright guys, we'll be back in just a little bit with the final portion of tonight's game. Don't go anywhere. Let's find out what type of main course they order. On a scale from 1 to 10, is Hal enjoying this?
Oh, Hal enjoys everything in life. So yeah, he's like a solid, you know. Are we doing percentages? Because then he's at
1 to 10, bro.
8.5. Oh. So he's on an 8. Yeah.
An 8.
Yeah, good 8.
Damn.
He's having a good time. He's actually clean. He's fresh. He's got nice duds on. He's got a little bow tie. He's feeling mm-hmm. fancy.
Wait, can we get a skill roll for how good her foot dexterity is?
No skill roll needed. Like, I'm telling you right now, she is giving you the old hootin' tootin'.
Is that what they call it? Is that what the kids call it these days?
Yeah, she does.
No.
Let me give you an idea of how skilled she is, right?
Mm-hmm.
Two toes, zipper down, mm-hmm. foot inside, mm-hmm. rubber dub dub, relaxing in the tub.
Does she have those freaky?
You've got some strange, sexy talk, Henley Bariah. Down with the clap.
She pulls out.
Does she have those weird?
She pulls out a squeaky nose, puts it on.
Now we're talking.
Down with the clap. Oh yeah. Does she start chugging Faygo at the same time?
Well, she's just like. So it's weird for you to call me like this, Hal. Sorry, I gotta get in the voice. I'm thinking the nanny. Yeah? Let's go with that.
Oh, how?
Oh, sweet.
It's weird for you to call me like this, how?
And she's like,
oh, we never established a hotness rule.
All right. This is for her attractiveness, people. Which is a real score in this game, so it's not unusual to ask for it. A 5. Solid fiver.
She's a fiver. All right.
But
I mean, Hal's only a 6, so.
Oh, really?
But yeah, he's only a 6, but he's got a 9 body. So he's buff, but he's not that. He's okay.
He's a buff butterface.
No. Yeah. So she's just like, you know, hand on hand, head on hand, foot under the table, giving you probably the best foot job you've had
Probably the only one. I don't know what you're into.
He's into everything, so probably the best one in a while. Is the best way to.
All right, let's get an endurance roll from you.
Sure. Which is endurance?
Hell's philosophy is to just do it.
It is. It really is.
I'm sorry.
In for a penny, in for a pound.
Yeah.
Oh, he's in for a pound.
Any hole's a goal.
Endurance. There it is.
Do you have any points in it?
I do not. But now I have one.
Oh, shit. Okay.
So, oops, I did that wrong. All right. Boop.
So that's 10 points off.
How's a fumble?
Yeah. Okay. So. So you're sitting there, you know, and the waiter comes over and you're just like.
Oh yeah.
Daddy needs may it. I see the wine list?
So
I've put an appropriate song in chat.
Yeah. You're like sweating, like you just like your whole chest is like sort of like perspirating and stuff.
Bread, more bread.
And he's just like, and the waiter in there is like, sir, would you like to test the wine?
Yeah. Bring me what do you recommend?
A wet wipe.
I like the idea that I like the idea that there's also another table over there. And it's like, I want whatever he's ordering.
He just have like a piece of bread. I'm like, yes!
Yes! This fucking bread! Oh my god!
Yes!
I've been on a gluten-free diet for weeks.
Can I get another napkin, please? Thank you.
Yeah, bring me whatever you recommend, and another napkin.
Fine, sir. I'll bring you the trout. And he like gives you an eye like up and down, like, oh yeah, he fucking knows that you just got a footsie under the table. So, you know, she just like smiles at him walking away, and then she's like goes back to you. Hal.
Yeah.
Why is it that you called me out of the blue?
Well, the thing is, I felt really bad about what happened in the past. So I wanted to try to touch base and make things right.
She just sort of smiles and gives you like a toothy grin. And she's like,
well, I'm just happy you're back in my life.
Right. So, you know the mayor, right?
What?
Well, he's been on the news lately. Have you been paying attention?
Oh, yeah. He's got that. Yeah, dark boy look going on.
Yeah. The thing is, he's like really causing a lot of trouble for some friends of mine. And
Hal, shut up.
Okay.
And she's like, where's that fucking wine?
Fuck wine. Oh, a friend of mine.
What?
Nothing. A friend of mine is trying their hand at making their own wine.
Hey, I got a great idea.
Yeah.
You want to blow this joint? There's a nightclub around the corner.
Sure.
I kind of want to take, like, anything that anyone wants to sell me tonight, you know?
And she, like, puts her hands in her hair and, like, flicks them out. She's just like, I want to make Dad pissed.
Just let me go to the bathroom real quick, and I'll be right back.
Can I come with you?
No.
Can we have a deception roll for you trying to hide your boner, as you said?
Well, it's not really a boner anymore, is it? It's the sticky patch.
No, he'd just be like, you know, napkin. Discreet napkin.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what are you doing in the bathroom?
Cleaning up. That's all.
Okay, I thought you might have been like trying to run away. Honestly, the reason I asked is because I thought you might be trying to run away. Right.
Oh, so. No, just cleaning my pants and just like, you know, washing my face, trying to get my cool back. You know, how's the manipulator? He's like, yes, you're in charge. You hold the reins. You have to make this deal work.
I am the damp patch.
I am.
I am the damp patch.
I am the one who knocks.
Okay. I'm writing that down. Okay. Yeah. So, you know, I like the idea that as you're leaving, the waiter's bringing out the food here, and she's just like, now get that shit away from me. I don't want it anymore.
Right. Sorry. We'll be taking our leave for the evening.
Hear that, bitch? Get out of my face. I really like this girl. I like playing this girl. Yeah, so you guys go clubbing. And she gets real fucked up. Like, real fucked up. To the point where she's like, you know, it's like one of those times where she's like, she like walks up to like the first tattooed guy she sees and she's like, sell me something I can put in my stomach. And he's just like, oh shit, all right. How much money you got? It's like, I don't know. He like hands over like a roll of like, you know, like a clip of money.
Mm.
And he just counts and he's just like, okay, open your mouth. And she's like, ah. And then she's like, you know, he puts like two tablets on her mouth and then like rolls her tongue back in her mouth. And she's like, there you go, honey. Have a good night. And she's like, thanks. And like runs off, like skips off back to where you are. And yeah, by the end of the night, she's just, you're like basically like girl on shoulder.
Shoulder.
He's just like, ugh. She's probably like, you know, maybe she's walking back and she's like vomits down your back like, bleh.
She's just there gurning.
I'll have to probably get rid of this jacket.
Yeah, she's
so my little bow tie is down by now.
Yeah, just like one just side.
Like, yeah.
So she's, in case I wasn't aware, she's like a real fucking train wreck, you know?
Mm.
Train wreck of a girl. Too much money to a name. It really depends on where, what your plan is now as to how you deal with this situation. I mean, you have plenty of options.
Yeah. Damn, I don't know much about her. I don't know her, how to get her home. I can rent the hotel room, right?
Oh, fuck yeah. She's still got a clip of money somewhere in her purse.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll do that. I'll find a local, like a local 4-star. I'm not going 5-star on her. Oh, fucking she's paying for it. 5-star.
Oh, yeah. Hang on. She might not have that much money.
Oh, okay. Well.
Hmm.
Something local, at least, so I don't have to carry her drunk ass everywhere.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, let's just say you find something.
Hal walks into a hotel room with a woman over his shoulder. I want a room.
I need a room.
And you get it. So the morning rolls around. You know, she stretches in the bed. She's like, are you there still?
Do
you
yeah, I'm still there. Yeah. Okay. It's a bed. Fuck yeah.
And she's just like, Hal.
What's up?
Did you do me last night?
I think so.
I feel like you did. This character writes herself, guys. It's just falling out of me like a fucking character. Like, bleh.
You're releasing your inner white girl.
That's me in a white girl.
Oh my god.
I feel like I did too.
I feel like I need to vomit again.
Me too.
She's just like, under the floor.
Gross. You have to remember, Hal is more used to hanging out with Riley, who can hold herself. Riley, yeah. Mm-hmm. I thought it was Riley. Yeah, Riley. Riley, yeah. He can hold herself together a little bit better than she can.
Disease resistance check. I don't think he went.
She's rich as fuck, right? She probably got a private doctor and shit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
She gets everything scraped out every few weeks.
And her doctor has more than one pair of gloves.
Yeah.
Wow.
He double bags his hands, you know what I'm saying?
Probably, yeah. And full mask and splash guard going on.
So
traumatized Tess.
you have an opportunity to make something of this night with her. What is your aim?
My aim is to try to get a job for me and the crew at her corporation.
Like a job or like something else? Like, what are you aiming for?
I want to set up a meeting with someone who can work with me. Like, I want, obviously she's not in charge of employment.
Give me a little bit more here. What type of job are you looking for?
I want to do the CE work for a corporation. They need someone down and dirty on the streets. I want that to be us.
Okay.
So I need to talk to like a manager or
okay.
Someone higher up.
In her purse is ringing. She's just like, like basically just like, and it's like some fucking like, what was it? There was like two white guys that made really shitty music. And it was like club music. God, what the fuck were they called?
Two white guys making shitty club music. He can narrow it down.
Oh, and they did a song. They did a song with Katy Perry. Oh, what were they fucking called? I'm literally googling Katy Perry song with two white guys. Okay, hang on. Let's see what comes out. It's 303 Starstruck. Yeah.
That's pretty good. 303.
Yeah, that's what's playing right now. Yeah, ringtone. Yeah.
You gonna get that?
Mm-hmm. No, she's fucking that.
Right. good morning. This is Halana Kahonui speaking for Susan.
You hear like the telltale signs of a guy like smoking a cigar. It's like, who now?
Halana Kahanui.
You like, you know, sound of a guy talking with a cigar in his mouth. Like, you got a white boy name?
Hal.
Hal. Why do you have Susan's phone?
Well, last night I saw her passed out on the club, and so I escorted her to a local hotel, and I guarded her doorway. She asked me to hold onto her phone in case anyone important called for her.
Where is she?
I believe she's in her room.
Where is she?
In her room, sir. I'm in the hallway.
Give me the location.
Oh, the hotel is the...
Yeah.
The Green Fillet.
Ah, yes. The Brown Fillet.
It's not as fresh as it used to be.
I'm sorry. I just took your idea and were like, fuck Peachy. This is my game.
It's like when Vi talks to Nina.
Idea. Yeah.
About the Brown Fillet.
So he'll,
I came up with this idea.
So he'll take another drag of his cigarette, of his thing, and be like, really long one. He'll be like, a car will come. You bring her back here, and we'll have a chat. Hal. And then he like hangs up.
Yes, sir. Right away, sir. Fuck off.
And then like you look at the call log. It says, "Daddy."
He's like, "Fuck."
I think that's where we'll leave.
That's a good spot to end.
Yeah. All right. So let's do some shout outs. Oh boy, fuck this episode, man. It's it took a lot out of me to do that. Tessica.
Hey there.
Hey.
Um
This was a very intense episode. It was good, though. Good. I stream every day, pretty much, except for Thursdays. Usually, I think this week I'm actually going to take that day off.
Nice.
I've had a little bit of a weird schedule lately. My computer kind of exploded, you know, went bleh for a while. And so I had to...
Vomited down the back of a Hawaiian man.
Yeah, pretty much. So I had to rebuild my whole stream last weekend, and it's working now. It worked this weekend, and it was good. My kitty got sick, which was really stressful, but hopefully she'll be okay. So that's good. And they have cat insurance, which is awesome. So that'll be good. And aside from that, I run a lot. I stream every day. Right now, I'm super into Neo. It's for always variety. I always have a heart rate monitor.
I want to play that so bad. And just like,
you should.
I will.
You
should. Let me finish my anime first, okay?
Okay. I mean, trust me. Mom, you will,
I want to anime my room.
You will start the game and get far ahead of me very quickly. So I'm not remotely worried. But so far, I've literally beaten the first real boss just today. And it's... I love it more than Bloodborne, which I never thought was possible.
Hearing you really say that makes me fucking happy to like play this game again because, and you know what? I heard the loading times are fucking exceptional in this game.
I haven't even noticed it, honestly. Like it's compared. I guess I have.
Bloodborne was like fucking you know, like you die and then it'd be like 5 minutes of loading and you'd be like, no.
Did you ever see Trav streaming that? He used to play like elevator music waiting for it to fucking load.
Really? Yeah. I mean, I guess I used the opportunity to talk to chat, so I don't really notice it as much.
Yeah, yeah.
But it definitely, it didn't bother me in Bloodborne, and I almost feel like it's too short in this game. Like, I find myself seeing the button to close the loading screen, because like, what I really like about this game is that when it loads, it gives you like a tip or some backstory or something interesting, right? And most games, when it's done loading, you'll switch, and like if you're trying to read it to chat, you can't because it's gone too fast, right? Especially on PC games. In this game, you have to hit a button, and I feel like there's just enough time for me to go use the restroom or read it to chat and like talk to chat for a minute. So it's nice. I think they're just right.
Yeah.
I just think it's beautiful and it's more complex and it has a lot more depth. I'm just barely gotten into it, so I can't really truly compare. Bloodborne is definitely my favorite sort of Ninja Soulsborne game. But I'm
I don't really think there's a lot of those. So I think it takes the top spot anyway.
Yeah. but Neo is certainly a contender for the top of that. I haven't played one yet. I haven't played Dark Souls 1. I didn't like 2. I liked 3, but I like Bloodborne better. I know Fuzzy is playing 1, and I've been watching her, and I really... Part of me wants to play it. Part of me is like, maybe this is better than I've... Maybe I'm judging it based on 2, and
two
I need to have a bit more of a chance.
2 was fucking awful. 2
that's,
was
it's not, that's
really
not fair
bad.
To Dark Souls. You can't judge Dark Souls 2 based on Dark Souls based on Dark Souls 2. They're almost completely different games.
I mean, I played 3, and I love 3. I don't love 3 as much as I love Bloodborne.
So here's the thing. 3 is a love letter to 1, and definitely not to 2. There are things in 3 which you probably think, oh, that's cool. But if you've played 1, you play 3 again, it's like, holy fuck, that thing's back. Like, it's like, it's kind of like having like, half the puzzle, you know? Like, yeah.
Yeah, or like when you get something...
I really want to know how you guys react to Neo, but I think I have been anti-1 for the wrong reasons that I need to give it a chance. So sometime this summer, after Mass Effect, after everything, I will find some time and I will try one.
Let me know when you get that up because I'll help you set up DS Fix to play with a mouse and keyboard.
That'd be awesome. Thank you.
That's important, but yeah.
Yeah, I've heard that. People have told me that before, but I've always been kind of intimidated by it. So thank you. I appreciate that.
No worries. So how many rolls did we make today? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's a record. 6 rolls. Not only this game is like a million, so yeah.
It was an awful heavy day.
Yeah.
And 2 of them weren't even real rolls.
That's true. Peachy Pixelate, what up, sir?
Yo, what up? It's your boy, Jimmy Jameson. Get me pictures of Spider-Man. Follow me on Twitch if you like roleplay. I do a lot of roleplay. Tomorrow, actually, I've got some D&D 5e called Fimble Winter at 10 p.m. GMT. I'll be streaming before that, so if you like streams, or if you follow me for that. And on Wednesday, we've got Board Games with Bearded Bros. There might be a lot of people on there. I know Fuzzy's down.
Did you overcommit? Did you overpromise with the board game?
Well, someone panged at me going, "Oh, we're playing. We haven't got any people." So I was like, "I'll just message some people." Everyone was like, "I want to play board games because everyone seems to really enjoy playing board games, which is cool." Ooh. So tune in Wednesday for that. That is 5 p.m. GMT. What is that in PST, Henry? I know
in
you
PST?
Know
this.
10. The
9 a.m. PST.
There you go.
It's 10. Yeah, it's 10.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We got Fuzzy. We might have McQuanis. We might have Brad Walter. We might have Kale. And McGloken is coming on again. So that's going to be
there
awesome.
There is no board game in existence that can hold all these people.
Unless
we play like Uno.
We're not playing Uno. I guarantee
you. The
Game of Life.
Game of Life teams.
I almost didn't want to put it on YouTube.
It's fucking hilarious.
On Friday on this channel, also at 6 p.m., 5 p.m.? Whatever.
At 5 p.m.
Gambit, Star Wars, which is legit.
Oh, right. 9 a.m. PST.
Ah, there we go. So tune in for that. But just follow me. I always host when I'm role-playing, and I usually stream before I role-play as well. Mm. Then I go eat, and then I go be a pretend badass. Because in real life, not so much.
Yeah. In real life, you just wander around in your pants and make sweet, sweet love to your little Star Wars figurine. You know it's true. It's why
I have absolutely no.
I love you, Fuzzy, and I love you, Peachy. You guys are amazing. Oh my god!
Nothing's that Kylo Ren has seen.
You guys are all amazing.
You're just like, not much, to be honest.
Yeah, even the astropath can't unsee what's happened in that room.
You have a question why his eyes are burned out?
Yeah. Fuzzy, let's go to you. Your show.
Hi. I'm Fuzzy Freaks, and I do fuzzy things over on twitch.tv/fuzzyfreaks. And at the moment, I am mostly wading my way through Dark Souls. Slowly.
Like a swan filled with the lust of souls.
No. Like a swan. Calm on the surface, paddling like fuck underneath. Yeah, I don't think I really praise the sun very much.
You should.
But yeah, I'm currently doing Sen's Fortress.
Sen's Fuckhouse. Get used to saying it.
I just need to find that bonfire. I'm going to scour the place with a bonfire.
You can do it.
Yeah.
Bite his fucking head off.
Yeah, I'm glad someone said it.
But yeah, and yes, and apparently I'm now basically Breaking Bad. In the game.
Yeah, I'm so fucking happy we went into that. Because this is literally like the first season of Breaking Bad now. He gets set up. Eventually, he throws down a bag of crystals and it explodes. You're going to do the same thing with like a Molotov. I am the one who knocks.
Is it bad if I've never seen the show?
No. I honestly haven't seen much Breaking Bad.
I don't think it was very good.
It's a slow burn, but it's really good.
I don't have the attention span for like TV series. I like watch two or three shows and I'm just like,
watch now? Luke Cage. Skip the first episode.
All the sci-fi shows, but the like the modern real-time modern day ones. Anyone that's a little bit too close to home is a little bit too close to home.
I will tell you something to watch. It is called Lethal Weapon, the TV show. It is actually really fucking good.
Looked funny when I saw the commercial.
It is really funny, and they do the movies so much justice. It is so good. Watch that show. Every episode has been fantastic. Yeah.
Anyway,
check it out.
That's me. It's my day off tomorrow. Yay. I might stream. I don't know. It depends how much sleep I get. But, you know. It's my day off.
Fuzzy because she's a badass. Seriously.
Speaking about the rare parrot of the group, Mr. Nightmare, aka the Floof.
What
Hello, everyone. You were expecting a Twitch streamer, but you got me, Nightmare. hello. I stream games on my channel as well. I'm currently playing through Final Fantasy X. I'm assuming I'll be doing X-2 after that, but I think I have a lot of Final Fantasy X first, because I only have like 10 hours, maybe. So I also have I probably barely scratched the surface of the game. But yeah, that's me. I host whenever I'm on Henley's channel, which is three times a week now. Time. Well, it's only three times now. Uh-huh. I'm only on half the shows, not the majority anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So, today I feel like I dominated tonight's game. Felt a little guilty about that, but that's fine.
I mean, we had some pretty good moments from every character.
That's true. That's true.
Yeah.
But yeah, if you like my roleplay, follow Henley and follow my channel as well, because I don't know. Promotion.
Follow that motherfucker right now.
Yeah, self-promotion, words, professionalism. Yeah, you know, stuff.
Yeah. And last but not least, in it.
Stop. I don't do shit. Yay, follow me anyways to make me feel better about going bald.
No, Chip is awesome and he has cats and he runs and he's just a really cool badass.
Yeah. I'm trying to be better about it. I am trying to be better about it.
You're doing more than me. I don't do shit.
Working out every day kind of sucks. But
you need one rest day. One. At least one.
Oh, yeah. No. I mean, like,
eat
I separate
seven pizzas during the day.
I'm doing even better. I have seven rest days.
Mate, I have fucking 8 rest days.
I mean, I'm still bulking, so I've been bulking for like the last 4 years, though. So
I need to start again.
Working out should be fun. One thing that I realized, I have a coach now and stuff, and like I was like, I'm gonna be really gung ho and go really fast and have a coach and make her like have her give me speed work and all this shit. And part of me likes it, part of me hates it. I've realized that if you do something that you really enjoy doing as a workout, even when it's hard, you'll keep doing it. But there's a point past which it becomes not as fun, and you shouldn't go past that point too often.
Yeah.
Because you don't want to make yourself stop. You don't want to make yourself hate it, you know.
For me,
point of no return.
For me, I'm a bit of a masochist, and I realize that like one of my the highlights of every night is like when I get out of my car to just like go grab my dinner, and like after leg day, and I just step down on the ground and I almost crumple and just fall to the ground. I just start giggling to myself because I'm just like, I just can't believe it. Like it's so hard.
You're a strange man.
Or like when you go to open a door and you're just like trying to do like a full bench press trying to get it open.
I mean, you heard the game that he likes to run as a GM. Come on.
True. I mean, he plays World of Warcraft.
Yeah, that's true.
Hey.
All right, guys. Wrong with that. Thank you very much for watching. Hope you enjoyed tonight's show. I hope it was excellent. We had a bit of a run-in last week with the ending, but I feel like we clawed back and we have something fucking great to work on now. So that's fucking excellent. please follow the channel if you enjoyed tonight's proceedings. Be that here on the Twitch stream, where it's live, or on the YouTube for the archive, or on the SoundCloud if you're listening with the ear holes, or on iTunes, wherever you might hear it. So a couple of things. First, we have a Patreon that supports Die Party, and everything Die Party does is patreon.com/Die Party or !! Patreon in the chat. You can go there and check that shit out. A couple of bucks will really help, and it'll help grow everything that is to be Die Party, because reason number two, we do 5 active games. It used to be 6, and we're probably going to replace the 6th one, but it takes a bit of time. But we do 5 active Die Party games a week. The first one is this one, Die Party Night City, Cyberpunk 2020. Second is Void Barons on Tuesdays, which is a rogue trader Warhammer 40k game. Very funny. Wednesdays is a free day. We'll be filling that eventually. Thursdays, we're starting a new game, because last week we ended one, called Die Party Yonder, which is a Numenera game about exploration and, just exploring. It's going to be cool. Fridays, we have a double up
Die Party Gambit at 9 a.m, which is a Star Wars Edge of the Empire game, and 5 p.m. PST, we have Die Party Omen, which is a Dungeons & Dragons 5th edition dungeon crawl. Very, very, very hard dungeon crawl. So, none of us have died yet, but we're getting real close. It's only a matter of time. And yeah, Board Games with Bitter Bros, as always, Wednesdays in the afternoon or in the morning, depending on which side of the world you're on. And yeah, exclamation point schedule. You can check out all the times there. Everything's all listed in easy to understand math. Calculus. That's pretty much it, guys. Thank you very much for watching. And remember, just because it's cheap doesn't mean it's good for you. Good night.